Please don't skip ahead yet. Hi, this is your friendly neighborhood 80's slasher librarian Josh LaRue. Just need a moment of your time. A lot of people don't know, but we're not able to monetize the channel here on YouTube due to the fact that the copyright holders of the books I narrate, the movies we rip, they get the ad revenue, and also being a partner on YouTube involves a lot of rules and censorship, and to do so would make it where a lot of the content, the audiobooks, the riffs, would have to be heavily censored or deleted completely. So we depend on amazing slashaholics like you to help fund the channel and keep it going and growing for years to come. And there's several fun ways to do that. You can join our Patreon right up there. And as a patron, you can join for as low as like $2, $5, $10 a month, on up as high as you want, and enjoy a lot of cool gifts like free ebooks, early access, exclusive content, even voicing characters and audiobooks here on the channel. You can also go to our PayPal and use the QR code right there, and you can donate directly to the channel. We see all donations and we appreciate all of them. If you don't want to use the QR code or don't know how, you can use our PayPal email address, which will be in the description below and the pinned comment, as well as our Cash App donation username. And a fun way to help the channel is through our Cameo right down there. On Cameo, you can ask for a birthday video, anniversary video. You can ask us to sing a song or something, or ask us questions. And you can get a video from me, Alex, Sean, Master Evil, Mother Evil, the Rodeo Clown, any character from any show on the channel, or any character that I've voiced in the audiobooks. It's a fun way to help the channel. It's only $10 a video, and we'll have a lot of fun doing that. So thank you so much for listening. I hope you enjoy tonight's content. Be excellent to each other. Please consider helping the channel. And always remember, the sun never sets on those who ride into it. Thank you. Hey there, Slashaholics. I've narrated a lot of slasher books here on the channel, but I wanted to tell my own story, my own fan fiction. A story I've thought of for a while called Friday the 13th Quarantine. I always wondered what would happen if we put a slasher story during the apocalypse. The end of the world happening all around, but slasher still does what a slasher does. So, I hope you enjoy my little story here. This story is not supposed to take place in the exact movie timeline with the films we know from Paramount and New Line. Look at this as kind of an Elseworlds story, a different universe where this is happening, a universe that is really similar to the Friday the 13th universe we know, but might have some slight differences and things happen a little differently. So here we go. You might recognize some familiar things from the film series, but keep in mind, this is a what-if, an Elseworlds-type tale. Friday the 13th Quarantine by Josh LaRue. Prologue. September 2003. After the killing spree by Jason Voorhees that stretched from Springwood, Ohio, all the way to Crystal Lake, New Jersey, authorities went to Camp Crystal Lake to investigate, under the impression the murderer, Jason Voorhees, was deceased. They were dead wrong. The first team of detectives and forensics experts were met with mass casualties. One uniformed patrolman did escape to tell the story, and a larger team was sent to the campgrounds to bring Jason back, dead or alive. Again, they were unsuccessful and lost many more men and women. For a while, they left Jason alone, not wanting to lose any more officers, so they barricaded entrances to Crystal Lake and pretended everything would be okay if no one went to those damned campgrounds again. Although some officers were furious, and they wanted him to face justice, and they started making phone calls higher and higher up. The government already had a file on Jason Voorhees, and with this new report, they took a deeper look. February 2004. The military was eventually dispatched, but was unable to locate Voorhees even though several soldiers were killed on this mission. Because of the nature of these slayings and inability to capture and detain Jason Voorhees, secret government agencies stepped in with a plan. If they couldn't put Jason Voorhees in their prison for observation, then they would make his home his prison. They could have opted to just destroy the entire area, but Jason's ability to avoid death and to seemingly regenerate injuries intrigued secret government scientists, who saw this imprisonment plan as a way to also observe and study this freak of nature. In an inhuman exercise that took place over an accelerated 48-hour period, the secret agency installed a large, impenetrable, solid steel wall around the Crystal Lake campgrounds, with electrified fencing and several watchtowers on the outside perimeter. For almost 3 years, Camp Crystal Lake was under 24-hour surveillance, and Jason was a prisoner in his own home. Until... July 2006. General Jameson Allen Andrews oversaw the top-secret 245B Trioxin project. This secret military project was a means of perfecting 245 Trioxin. Its effects would reanimate corpses with an unending hunger for human brains. The idea originally was to use Trioxin in combat on the enemy, so the U.S. military could literally reanimate their fallen enemies, which would in turn begin attacking the living ones. The problem was, the original 245 Trioxin was chaotic and didn't just reanimate corpses, but anyone within the radius of its airborne form would slowly die themselves and become the undead as well. This was counterproductive in close combat. So 245B Trioxin was made to be a modified form that did not affect the living. That is, unless they were bitten or scratched or ingested the blood of a 245B reanimated corpse. A living subject who simply came into contact with 245B Trioxin, airborne or otherwise, would not perish and reanimate. However, the new formula had other surprise results. It made the undead even more vicious and bloodthirsty than before. Now, instead of brains, the reanimated corpses would devour any living creature whole. It needed and demanded not just the brains, but also the organs, blood, and flesh of animals and humans constantly to satiate its hunger. General Andrews had completed all field trials of 245B Trioxin and was set to reveal his results to the top of the ladder. That is, until his son, Lieutenant Jesse Andrews, was taken as a hostage by a terrorist cell in Iran called Axis. General Jameson Andrews attempted to use his power and influence to get his son home safely, but the president and his cabinet refused to negotiate with the terrorist. General Allen begged and pleaded with the president to no avail. Shortly later, in September 2006, Axis released an execution video of Lieutenant Jesse Andrews, citing their demands not being met by the President of the United States. General Andrews slipped into a dark depression at the loss of his only son. He blamed the president and his cabinet. General Andrews smiled and shook the president's hand at his son's memorial, but his revenge was already in play. He would show the president death. On September 13, 2006, General Andrews went rogue and launched 5 missiles at Washington, D.C., loaded with 245B Trioxin. Only 1 missile hit its mark, while the others were taken out in the upper atmosphere. No one other than General Andrews had knowledge that the missiles held 245B Trioxin, and when they were destroyed, the Trioxin spread into the atmosphere and would go on to be distributed across the entire continent and further. In rainstorms, snow, sleet, and ice, everything happened so fast. The missile that struck D.C. hit its desired target, the United States Soldiers and Airmen's home national cemetery. The release of the 245B Trioxin, coupled with a rainy fall day, caused a mist to rise and flow across the cemetery. The dead rose almost immediately, and chaos ensued. If D.C. had been the only place the dead were reanimating, then it may have been stopped. But the Trioxin that spread across the atmosphere was already seeding into rain clouds across the continent and beyond. And within hours, the dead were rising in so many places and infecting so many of the living that the military never had a chance. General Andrews had gotten his revenge, and now the entire world would soon pay. September 13, 2006, Crystal Lake. Jason was aware that he was being watched. They'd been watching for a long time now, and they had built their walls to keep him in. He knew those walls wouldn't hold him, but he had no desire to leave. He didn't want them in his home. The ones who killed Mother. The ones who let him drown. They always showed up, came into his home, and he would kill them all. Mother said so. "Kill for Mother. Kill them. Kill them all," she had said. He still heard her voice. He still had Mother's decayed head in his small shack where he stayed. He was glad they were leaving him and Mother alone. But if they tried again to take him away from Mother, he would kill them all again. Over 2 years had passed since they turned Camp Crystal Lake into Jason's prison. Over 2 years with no visitors, no groups of drunk stoners having sex like the counselors that were supposed to be watching Jason, or like the counselor that had lopped off Mother's head. And in those 2.5 years of no outliers in his home to fight back and hurt him, Jason had almost fully regenerated to his original human form. His skin was almost normal. His scars were disappearing. He moved quicker than he had in a long time. Both his eyes could see again, and he felt stronger than ever. Jason was walking along the bank of Crystal Lake as the evening sun was suddenly covered by dark, heavy rain clouds. The rain fell hard and fast, as if out of nowhere, and a strange mist began to rise off the lake and across the ground at Jason's feet and beyond into the trees. Jason cocked his head and peered through his battered hockey mask across the lake as he began to hear a gurgling sound, and he noticed several spots of the lake where water looked as if it was boiling and bubbling. As Jason watched, the mist began to dissipate, and then he saw a bony hand reaching from the depths in one of the bubbling spots upon the lake. He turned his attention to the other spots and saw more remains rising to the surface, decayed flesh hanging from bones. He had seen this happen before not too long ago, when the girl with the powers had hurt him like none other. As he attempted to kill her and her meddling boyfriend, a decaying corpse had risen from the depths and pulled him down and held him prisoner under the water, until he was set free and awoken by a boat that led him away from his home to a place far away that he hated. He had found his way home that time, but he would not let it happen again. He would not be pulled under this time. As he watched the corpses begin to float and wade towards him on the shore, Jason removed the machete from his waistband. He stood on the bank of Crystal Lake holding the machete. He wore a faded blue work shirt, torn black pants, worn work boots, and of course the hockey mask that gave him comfort and hid his deformities. He was going to fight. He was going to kill. He was going to protect his home. As he watched the bodies moving in the lake towards him, he heard a snap behind him. He was not alone on the banks of Crystal Lake. He spun to see the corpses of three of his very own victims that were never found. He didn't understand how they were here. He had done what Mother had said. He had killed them all. But here they were, shambling towards him, their arms outstretched, teeth gnashing, and he was their target. The first of the three was a male who had camped out in Crystal Lake with two females shortly after the police had given up on capturing Jason. Jason had found them in the throes of a drunken threesome in a tent, and he had drugged the male from the tent and hacked off one of his arms with his machete. And as the man tried to crawl away, Jason had twisted his head completely around. And now here he was, the man from the tent, with his one remaining arm reaching behind him towards Jason, his rotted head and empty eye sockets staring at Jason as he walked backwards towards the slasher. Jason swung his machete with purpose and lopped off the backwards head of the male, but the body kept coming. The head watched from the ground, its tongue wagging, its bottom jaw was now detached. It sounded like he was trying to speak. The body turned around and was now facing Jason, and its one hand grabbed Jason's shoulder.
Jason acted fast, hacking off the remaining arm, then the legs. The remains were still twitching on the ground at Jason's feet. Jason was confused, but his instinct was to kill. He swiftly cut the head on the ground in half and turned his attention to the other two corpses coming out of the woods. It was the two girls from the threesome. He had reached into the tent that night and grabbed them both by the back of their heads and dragged them out of the tent as they slapped and scratched at him. Their death was swift. He simply slammed their heads together, shattering their skulls and turning their faces to mushy, bloody messes. And now, those smashed and also rotted faces stared at him through what used to be their eye sockets, but now was nothing more than sunken, decayed flesh over shattered faces. Their skeletal arms reached and grabbed at Jason, but before they could do any damage, he again grabbed them by the back of their heads and slammed what remained of skulls together again and again until there was nothing left. The bodies dropped to the ground twitching. Jason began hacking and hacking at the three corpses and limbs on the ground until they ceased to move. In the chaos, Jason had neglected the lake behind him, and if not for his supernatural keen senses, he may have been ambushed from behind. But he heard a splashing sound and spun around inhumanly fast and saw an almost completely skeletal body not 6 feet in front of him, walking from the water. Barely any flesh remained, but it was coming at him. And behind it, 5 more corpses in similar condition were making their way to the bank of the lake and to Jason. Jason didn't recognize the corpses, though he knew they had to have been victims he had dispatched in years past. But that wasn't important. He heard his mother's voice in his head.
Jason, my special boy. They want to hurt you, Jason, like they hurt me. Don't let them, Jason. Don't let them hurt you.
The confusion of how the corpses were returning and his mother's words sent an inhuman rage surging through his body, and his machete moved fast, and within seconds, he had struck down all the corpses that had risen from his lake. Jason stared out on the water and saw the lake was calm again. He turned back around and at his feet, noticing some limbs still twitching, he crushed them until there was nothing left to move. Jason was confused and furious. He needed to see Mother. He made his way into the woods of Crystal Lake and headed straight for his ramshackle home in the deepest part of the woods surrounding Crystal Lake. The police and military had never found it, but that was because Jason never let them. Anyone who even came close to finding it wouldn't live to see the shack, or if they did, they wouldn't live to tell others. Jason entered his shack and heard a strange snapping noise coming from the back room. Mother's room. Jason charged into the back room of the shack and saw his mother's head. But it wasn't just sitting there anymore. Its mouth was moving, and its eyes opened and saw him standing before it. Jason blinked from behind his hockey mask. Mother was awake.
Jason,
the head of his mother rasped. Jason knelt before Pamela Voorhees' head and watched intently.
Jason, my special boy, is that you?
It asked. Jason did not answer. He only watched.
Mother is hungry, Jason. You must feed me, Jason. Feed me, Jason, and we will never be apart again.
Jason didn't even wonder how a head alone could eat, but he knew he never wanted to lose Mother again. Mother had come back to him. He didn't care how or why. He only knew one thing. He would feed Mother. He took 2 bear traps off the wall in the front room of his shack that were hanging next to a special trophy of his. tattered red and green fabric wrapped around a glove affixed with four rusted razor-sharp blades. He didn't give another thought to the corpses that came back from the dead. He had no idea that the world outside his prison was ending, and that soon there would be no more people watching him from their towers. No, Jason had one mission: feed Mother. So he set out to hunt, and hunt he did. He would hunt and kill any animal that remained in his prison of a home at Camp Crystal Lake, and he would feed and be with his mother. And so he did, for a time. Chapter 1. Friday, January 13th, 2008.
Ah! No! No!
Rex yelled as a hand burst through the snow, grabbing his ankle and tripping him to the ground.
Wait! Don't leave me!
He yelled to the group that he had been traveling with since the refugee center that was set up at Fort Dix Army Base in Burlington, New Jersey, had been overrun with Trioxites. They had done so well there as well. Over a year, they lived in safety and security, with military protection. But now that was all over. Rex was 25. He was a handsome guy. He had been an insurance agent and made very good money. He was Latino, 6'1", average build, very short brown hair, and a neat goatee. Rex didn't even know these people. He was there with his fiancée Betsy, or Bet for short. Shortly before the gunfire and the chaos, she had went to the latrines, and when all hell broke loose, he had no choice but to run. It happened fast. Hundreds died and then came back to join the army of the Trioxites. He tried to go back for Bet, but then he saw her within the horde. Some Trioxites are able to communicate, but too many times he saw them manipulate the living only to kill them and devour them. He loved Betsy, but knew he would never be able to hurt her if he had to defend himself against her. He got in one of the buses that were leaving the base, and it wasn't all bad luck that day. The bus he got on held 22 others. They could have fit more, but the Trioxites had gotten too close and they had to leave dozens of people behind to feed or join the army of the undead. But being one of the 22 to get away on that particular bus wasn't the only lucky part. The luckiest part was that one of the 22 on that bus was a United States Senator from New Jersey, Thomas Wilcox, aka Tom, as he liked to be called. Tom knew where another safe zone was. All communications and radio signals were dead, but he knew of a base in Illinois that he said was impenetrable, and since he was the only one with a plan, everyone agreed and they began their trip to sanctuary and safety. Their trip had been stalled several times as the Trioxites outnumbered the living. Bigger cities fell so fast and spawned so many new undead, and they traveled together in giant hordes, hunting and tracking survivors until they had them. Sometimes they'd devour them all, and sometimes they'd add numbers to their ranks. They had been quite lucky for the first few weeks, even though they had had to change trajectory several times, causing major setbacks. And now a particular Triox horde had been tailing the 22 refugees for over 2 weeks. In the process, the number in the group had been dwindled down to 10. There was the dad and his two teens, that was Harry Miller, the father and his 19-year-old son Mark and 17-year-old daughter Janine. Harry was a retired firefighter. He had been there on 9/11 and lost many brothers and sisters that day. He carried that pain and regret in the crow's feet and wrinkles on his suntan face. He wasn't especially tall or muscular. He was an average 5'10", weighed around 220 pounds, and looked much older than he was. At only 47, you'd think he was pushing 60. His dark hair speckled with bright white. He was the definition of salt and pepper hair. His two teens couldn't be any more different than their dad. Mark stood at 6'3", was lanky, weighing around 160, had short dark hair, but he was fit and was a fast runner. He had volunteered several times to get in and out of places when the group needed supplies. His sister Janine was gorgeous. She was 5'3", 115 pounds, soaking wet. She had an hourglass figure, wasn't skinny, wasn't big. She was curvy in all the right ways, and the most beautiful crystal blue eyes. Rex had caught himself staring at her large C-cups many times, only to turn red-faced when she'd catch him looking and smile and push her hair behind her ears. But Rex knew she was only 17, and he was still missing Betsy. Though it was a cold, lonely world out there, and facing it alone wasn't an option anymore. Rex wasn't sure if he'd ever act on his infatuation with Janine or her infatuation with him. But for now, he was enjoying the view. Then there was Tom Wilcox, the senator. He was kept safe at all costs, as the group would need him to be admitted to this secret base he spoke of. Tom was exactly what you would expect out of a senator. He was 5'9", stocky, out of shape, neat gray hair, blue eyes, clean-shaven, and somehow always seemed clean, no matter how long they went without a means to wash. There was a 21-year-old college football star, Kevin Cunningham. He was cocky and arrogant and kept a running tally of how many trioxides he had killed. His current number was 299, and he was dying to hit that big 300. He wouldn't shut up about it. He was a muscular black man. He had short curly hair, brown eyes, and was lean. He had been on a full scholarship and was set to be a shoo-in for the NFL. And then, just like everyone else's dreams and aspirations, it was snatched away from him when the Trioxin fell. Rounding out their motley crew of end-of-the-world survivors was Ron and Dorothy, the older stuck-up couple. They were obviously very wealthy back when money still meant something. They had even somehow gotten special treatment at the refugee camp and constantly reminded Tom Wilcox that they had donated to his campaign several times, already trying to get in good with the senator to keep their upper-class identity for when the group made it to the base in Illinois. Ron Savinsky was 65 years old, short and plump at 5'6", horseshoe baldness with dyed black hair and a dyed black mustache and thick glasses. And his wife, Dorothy, was only 54. She was 5'8 and very attractive for her age. She had definitely had work done on her face and breasts, as her double D's didn't quite move like Mother Nature intended. She had long, elegant blonde hair and bright green eyes, and looked not a day over 45. And finally, that left the mystery twins, Adrian and Sally Ann. These girls were very quiet and secretive. They kept to themselves and didn't really talk much with the rest of the group. But when things got tough, they would do their part. They were identical in every way. 5'4", long red hair, fair skinned, hazel eyes, and a modest B-cup. The only difference between the two was a scar on Sally Ann's neck from a car accident when they were children. Out of the 12 that had been lost so far since fleeing the base, two of them were their parents. In fact, if not for their parents being taken by the Trioxites, when the horde surrounded the bus not 15 minutes earlier, then the 10 of them that remained wouldn't have gotten the small head start that they were now taking full advantage of, running for their lives and hopefully finding transportation or shelter through the New Jersey wilderness. For the most part, Rex felt the most inadequate of the group. It seemed like when the shit hit the fan, everyone left out of the 10 except for him knew what to do and stepped into go mode. Rex seemed to always fuck up something. And now, after the horde had overtaken their bus, the group was on foot fleeing from the damn Triox horde that had been stalking them for the past 14 or so days. And of course, it was Rex that fucked up yet again.
"Guys, it's got me! Help!"
Rex yelled again. Harry turned around to run back and help Rex, but as he did, the Trioxite that had been under the snow and grabbed Rex's ankle was now unsubmerged, and before Rex could pull away, it had bitten into his throat as his screams for help turned into gurgles, and more Trioxites from the horde caught up and fell upon Rex as well. The group had dwindled again down to 9. The only silver lining at that moment was Rex would buy them some time.
"Dad, it's too late, come on!"
Mark yelled to his father as he grabbed his arm and pulled him back in the other direction. The group ran in silence, putting more distance between themselves and the horde that was surely gaining ground somewhere behind them. They had ran into a dense wooded area, and they were beginning to lose any semblance of direction, when out of nowhere, the group of nine came out into a huge clearing of snow-covered ground leading up to a giant wall and huge fencing. It went off to the left and right as far as the eye could see, with a slight curvature, and scattered along the big wall were what seemed to be watchtowers tagged with the letters OP-CL-JV. Everyone in the group except Senator Tom Wilcox began to slow down and come to a stop, staring ahead and up at the huge structure before them in awe. "Whoa, welcome to Jurassic Park," said Kevin. Senator Tom was still running and had reached the wall and was frantically running his hand along the surface of it, wiping snow away as if he was looking for something. As his hand knocked snow away, large graffiti could be seen on the wall reading Camp Blood and another section that read Rotten Hell, Maggot Head, with the initials TJ under it. Everyone was looking at the structure and almost forgot what they were running from until they could hear the ungodly groaning and moans of the undead coming from the thicket of trees somewhere behind them. They all ran up to the senator, who was still frantically running his hand along the wall.
"What the hell are you doing, Tom?" Harry demanded.
"It's gotta be here somewhere. Just shut up and let me look," Tom responded.
"Just what are you talking about? What has to be here? Do you know where we are?" Ron prodded.
The group began murmuring, asking all at once what Tom was looking for.
"Shut up, I found it!" Tom yelled frantically, looking back at the tree line.
The noise of the horde was getting closer, but the tree line was still uninhabited for now. Tom pushed on a small section of the wall, and a rectangular section no more than 1 foot by 1 foot opened up, and a handle was inside. Tom pulled the handle to the right, and the group heard a loud click, and directly to the left of that small opening, a section of the wall seemed to move in a couple inches, but no more.
"Damn it! No power! God damn it! And the snow! It's so deep, and no one has been maintaining it! We have to push!" Tom ordered.
"We aren't doing anything until we get some answers," Harry chided.
"Yeah, dude, like, how did you know to open that wall and pull that handle?" Kevin asked.
"Yes, Tom, as your friend, I demand to know why you've kept this from me," Ron asked in his annoyingly entitled tone.
Everyone had their back to the tree line facing Tom, but Tom was facing them and could see the tree line as hundreds of trioxites began to appear along it. Tom pointed behind the group, then turned and started pushing on the section of wall that had moved.
"God damn it, push! They're here!" Tom screamed.
The group looked back and stopped their interrogation and began pushing with all of their might. The section began to move slowly. The wall was so thick and heavy, it seemed impossible they'd get it open enough to squeeze through in time. The horde was less than a football field's distance away as the section began to move a little faster, and the group could see a heavily wooded area through the crack. And as it opened enough to make room for them, everyone began frantically squeezing through and lining up on the other side to push it back closed. The twins were the last ones through. And as Adrian was squeezing through and got clear, a decayed hand shot through.
"Let us in! We'll eat you quick!"
a trioxite said in a gravelly voice. More began taunting them as well as they pushed against the section, trying to get in with the group of survivors. Kevin, who was actually quite smart and quick-witted, used his football problem-solving and went into action. Everyone had grabbed what little supplies they could in the chaos of fleeing the bus when the horde had attacked, and Kevin had only had time to grab one thing, a large axe. As the group was pushing with all of their might to close the section off, before trioxites could get through, Kevin began chopping a tree that was adjacent to that section of wall. He stopped and ran to the group and pushed with all of his might, and against all odds, they got the section closed off enough to stop any trioxites from getting through. But they couldn't hold it that way forever. They would tire. The undead would not.
"When I say so, everybody move," Kevin ordered.
They didn't need it explained. Everyone was on the same page and watched as Kevin ran back to the tree he'd been chopping. He swung the axe again and again and heard a loud crack. "Move!" he yelled, and the group listened. As soon as they let go and ran away from the falling tree, they saw the section of wall start to open again and light coming through. But it was short-lived as the large tree landed against the wall at an angle, the bottom section of the tree hitting hard and digging into the ground, creating enough support to stop the large section of wall from opening. For now. Kevin went to another tree and repeated his work, and another tree fell against that section of wall right next to the first. They could hear the horde outside moaning, groaning, and taunting them. But for now, the group was safe and had found shelter and security. But the question on everyone's mind was, how? As the group collectively caught their breath, they all turned their attention towards Senator Tom, who was actively looking around at their new surroundings.
"Okay, Senator. Time to start talking," Harry demanded.
"Daddy, maybe we should just be happy we're safe," his daughter Janine said. "No, if he knows something that we don't, we need answers," her brother Mark replied.
"Yeah, dude, like, I'm happy we're safe and not being digested by some asshole corpse with a big mouth, but I'd kind of like to know where we are and how you knew what to do," Kevin added.
"Yes, I must say I am quite perturbed myself, Thomas, and I implore you to explain to me why I was left out of the loop," Ron demanded.
"Honey, think of your blood pressure," his wife warned him.
"Look, everyone is safe. Isn't that all that matters? Not sure if you people have noticed or not, but there is a bad snowstorm moving in off to the west. I can explain everything in good time, but for now, we need to find shelter and take inventory of what supplies we have and what supplies we need. There is a campground not far from here, cabins, multiple structures. Let's get there and I will answer any questions you have. Deal?"
the silver-tongued politician remarked, hoping he had bought himself time by kicking the can down the road a bit.
"If we keep heading in, we should come straight to the cabins. So do we have a deal?"
The group looked at each other. Everyone took a breath and nodded.
"Lead the way, Senator," Harry said. "But we will have answers soon."
Tom smiled his best politician smile and said, "You betcha." The group began their trek to the cabins of Camp Crystal Lake. Jason had no idea that him and his mother had visitors. He had been hunting for and feeding mother for over a year now. He didn't know that the world outside his home had ended, and that the dead were walking the earth and hunting the living. He had mother, and mother had her special, special boy. But Jason's world was about to end in a sense as well, very soon. But at this particular moment, only one thing was important. It was time to feed mother. Jason took his machete off the wall, put it in his waistband and left his shack, and walked into the snow-laden forest to check his traps and find food for mother. As he walked, a thought crossed Jason's mind. Jason was feeling something he hadn't felt since a very young age. Something that now felt strange and alien. He had mother. It was like before he drowned. Before that nasty counselor took mommy away. Jason no longer felt the rage and bloodthirst, no. It was true. There was no denying it. Jason felt content. Even happy?
Chapter 2. A Cold Day in Hell. The senator was correct on two fronts. First, there indeed was a snowstorm on the way. The group could feel the temperature dropping by the minute, and the clouds were dark, low, and heavy above them. It was only late afternoon, but seemed like it was almost dark. Luckily, the other thing the senator was correct about was that they were indeed not far from cabins. Within 20 minutes of walking, the group came upon a grown-over trail in the dense woods. They followed it for another 10 minutes and came upon a set of cabins in a clearing. On the other side, the trail continued into another patch of woods with a sign that said Campsite C/Crystal Lake Dock. The group decided to investigate the current set of cabins before going any further into the Camp Crystal Lake grounds. Where they stood, they were surrounded by three cabins and a shed marked maintenance. One of the cabins was completely collapsed, as well as the shed. Another cabin's chimney was collapsed, which left the third cabin that seemed to be completely intact. Like I said before, I will tell you everything you want to know. But for now, let me assure you, we are surrounded on all sides by that wall. We are completely safe. I know you want information, and I will give it, but that storm is coming soon. So shall we see how this cabin looks inside? Senator Tom said, while pulling out a flashlight from a backpack he had over one shoulder. He turned the knob of the cabin's front door, and it opened slowly. Mark and Sally Ann also had flashlights, and they stepped in with Tom, and the three shone their lights around the dark cabin. It was covered in dust and cobwebs, with old furniture strewn about, and to their left an old rotted table broken in the middle and laying in two pieces. The rest of the group stepped in behind the three flashlight bearers, and together they investigated what turned out to be the largest of the three cabins. They found a bathroom with a broken window, with snow covering the shower and the toilet. Tom let out a shriek as he startled himself when he shone his light on the mirror. They also found three bedrooms. All three rooms had old bunk beds and twin beds running along their walls. They guessed this cabin had been the counselor's quarters. There was 10 beds in all, including 3 bunk beds between the three rooms. There was even an old rotted hammock in the corner of one room. Once their tour was over, they all returned to the main room and stood around the empty stone fireplace. "Not too shabby. Will be a good place to wait out the storm," Senator Tom began. "We need to just clean the place up, make sure the chimney is clear, and we can start a fire and stay warm."
"I'm not sure if you noticed, but we didn't exactly get off the bus with a lot of supplies, Senator. My kids and I will check out Campsite C and the docks and see if there's anything we can use, maybe some non-perishables or clothes," Harry volunteered.
"Yes, yes, good. We will also need firewood and lots of it. And someone needs to dig a latrine pit unless we want to clear out a room full of snow and use a restroom with no running water," Tom added.
"Well, don't look at me. I'm old and beat down and have high blood pressure," said Ron.
"And I simply must be by his side in case he has an episode and needs my help," his wife chimed in.
"I saw a shovel outside. I'll dig us a pit for now close to the cabin out the back door. Do I even need to ask, or is it already obvious who our volunteer lumberjack should be?" Tom said, with a smile, turning his light on Kevin. "What do you say, champ? Can you use that game-winning chop-action arm strength of yours to get us some firewood and keep us warm for the night?"
"You should really put some chapstick on before you go kissing someone's ass that hard, Senator. All you had to do was ask. We all," Kevin turned a glare towards Ron and Dorothy, "need to do our part to make it, together."
Kevin held the axe over his shoulder and walked towards the front door.
"And don't think we've forgotten, Tom. You got some answers to give us when we're settled."
With that, Kevin walked out of the cabin and onto a trail that went off into the woods on the right side of the cabins. Harry and his son and daughter walked towards the front door as well and turned towards Senator Tom.
"He's right, Tom. When we get settled and get a fireplace going, we're going to have some questions. Questions about how you knew about this place, what this place is, and exactly how accidental us being here actually is," Harry said, calmly but with an intensity in his eyes. Then he added, "Here's your shovel for the ship pit. See you soon."
Harry reached next to the front door and picked up a shovel that was leaning against the wall. He gently tossed it towards Tom, who dropped his flashlight and caught the shovel. Harry, Mark, and Janine walked out of the cabin and headed down the trail that led to Campsite C and the Crystal Lake Dock. Ron and Dorothy had found 2 wooden chairs that were still sturdy, sitting next to the broken table,
and they offered their services of making sure the chairs didn't fly away by sitting their entitled asses down in them. How about it, girls? Think you can spruce up the place a bit? Make it a little more livable for everyone? Be team players, Tom said, and then dropped his fake smile as he remembered something. Oh, girls, I'm so sorry. In all the chaos, I just forget. It all happened so fast. I am so sorry for your loss. My thoughts and prayers are with you both, and I know this is a trying time, and I know it's hard losing your parents, but could you find the strength to help the group out and just knock down some of these cobwebs, pull out some beds in here, straighten up some? Tom said, with obviously rehearsed inflection that he had used dozens of times as a politician. You can stop the cell, Senator. Yeah, we will clean up, but we've been watching you. You wanted to come here. This was where you were leading us, not Illinois. We know you're up to something, and if you don't start giving the group some answers, we're going to tell them what we've seen you do when no one else was looking, Sally Ann said matter-of-factly. We know about the folder in your pack, Tom. The one marked like the watchtowers, OP-CL-JV. When everyone gets back, you tell us everything, or we tell them, Adrian added. All right, and who said you girls were so quiet? No need to threaten anyone. When we all get back and get a nice warm fire going and figure out our next move, I will tell the group everything, you have my word. He held up his fist with his thumb sticking up, like so many politicians have done while giving a speech throughout history. He smiled, gave them a wink, and walked out the back door and started digging.
I love my little nasty girl, all my women from around the world. I love my little nasty girl, all the ladies, if you're with me, grab your titties for B.I.G.
Kevin sang to himself as he walked the snow-covered trail through the woods of Crystal Lake. For the first time in a long time, Kevin felt a sense of peace. It was nice knowing that a wall the size of the one King Kong was kept behind surrounded this entire place. Not having to worry about a horde of trioxides attacking while you try to sleep was a nice feeling. Kevin couldn't believe that tonight would be the first night since the trioxin fell that he would be able to sleep without one eye open. He caught himself missing normality. He then thought more about King Kong, then thought about Jack Black and how he had been surprised at just how good Jack Black had been in that King Kong remake. And then Kevin found himself getting angry that the fucking apocalypse had completely ruined him getting to see Tenacious D in The Pick of Destiny. That was a movie that was going to come out back in November 2006, 2 months after the Trioxin fell. If not for the apocalypse, he was sure that that movie would have gone on to be one of the biggest hits of the year, if not the decade. He went back to singing while he looked for the perfect tree to chop.
You know I love my little nasty girls. I need you to dance, I need you to strip. I need you to shake your little ass and hips. I need you to grind like you're working for...
Oh, shit! Kevin was distracted and didn't see the root that stuck out above the ground and barely shone above the snow. And his foot went right inside it and he tripped and started going down. Down a very steep hill that ran along the trail that the snow had already made hard to follow. Kevin had the presence of mind to remember he had the axe strapped to his back. He hoped against hope he didn't end up getting his damn head cut off. Finally, after what seemed like an eternity, Kevin came to stop against a fallen tree at the bottom of the incline. As the world spun around him, Kevin stood, hands on his knees, bent over, trying to get his bearings. After a few moments, he shook his head and stood up to take inventory of his surroundings. Nothing but trees and snow as far as the eye could see. But wait, what was that? Off in the distance, Kevin saw something that didn't quite belong. He started walking towards it, and as he got closer, he could see what looked to be a shack that someone had built out of a mismatch of boards, siding, logs, and sheet metal. It had a crooked window on the side and an uneven doorway. Kevin didn't hear anybody nearby and assumed it was perhaps a clubhouse some kids at camp had built a long time ago. Just in case, though, he pulled the axe off his back and held it in his hand as he walked through the doorway. The smell almost knocked him off his feet. He held his hand to his nose as he looked around. There were animal hides everywhere, as well as animal skeletons and flies and maggots all over the animal corpses, strewn on the floor, shelves, and on a makeshift table. And then he saw to his left an old toilet that at one time had surely been white, but was now a faded yellow and covered in feces and urine. On the walls he saw bear traps, machetes, knives, and even a glove with a metal frame housing four rusted razor-sharp-looking blades. It was partially wrapped in green and red fabric. As he was looking around, he accidentally kicked an animal carcass and made a loud crack as a bone of the dead animal broke under his weight. Kevin stood frozen in place, and as he realized this couldn't be a clubhouse from years gone by, and someone was surely here recently, he heard a voice call from the small room in the back of the ramshackle structure.
Jason, my special boy, is that you? Jason, mommy's hungry, Jason. Feed mother,
the voice called out. Kevin took his axe in both hands and slowly walked towards the back room. He inched slowly towards the doorway. He noticed a small flickering candlelight coming from the room in an even stronger stench. As he drew closer, he saw a shadow on the wall of what appeared to be perhaps a basketball or something like it sitting upon a table, but no shadow of a woman like the voice he heard. Hello? Kevin called.
You're not my Jason. You shouldn't have come. My special boy will be home soon, and I'm hungry. Perhaps you'll be dinner, you foolish boy,
the voice replied.
I'm not going to be anybody's dinner, bit.
Kevin's voice trailed off as he finally walked through the opening and saw the decayed, decapitated head of a trioxide sitting on an old tattered sweater on top of a makeshift shrine.
What the fuck?
Kevin shouted, holding the axe up defensively.
You wandered into the wrong place, boy. You have no idea who you're messing with,
the head threatened. Kevin smiled as a fun thought came to him, and with that smile on his face, he replied,
Au contraire, my fair lady. I know exactly who I am messing with. Number 300!
With those words, Kevin brought the axe down to the middle of the head, splitting it almost in half, and silencing Pamela Voorhees forever.
Yes! Yes! 300, baby! Wait till I tell the group!
Kevin put the axe back across his back and picked up the silenced head, laughing to himself, and walked out of the shack.
How long have you been here talking to yourself, you old bitch?
Kevin asked the decapitated head that would never answer again. As Kevin walked out of the shack, too excited that he finally got to kill his 300 trioxide to realize that somebody had to put those animals in there, he turned back in the direction he had come from and started walking, looking down at the head in his hands.
You're no fun anymore. Horrible conversationalist. See you later, number 300. You've been fun.
With that, Kevin absently tossed the head over his shoulder behind him and took a few more steps. Before a realization hit him, he never heard the head hit the ground. Kevin slowly turned around and almost pissed himself when his eyes fell upon the large bald man standing not far from the shack and not far from Kevin. He wore a battered, weathered hockey mask over his face and was holding the head of the woman in both hands, looking down at it. Kevin began to slowly back away when the large man's head snapped up inhumanly fast, and Kevin felt the rage and hatred radiating from the eyes that glared at him from behind the hockey mask. The man in the hockey mask dropped the head to the ground and pulled a machete from his waistband. Kevin didn't even stop to think. He pulled the axe from across his back and held the handle in both hands and threw it with all of his might towards the giant before him. The axe spun in the air, but the man in the mask simply swiped it down with his machete. Kevin didn't wait to see what happened next. He spun around and ran for his life. He had no idea where he was going. He just knew he had to run. The man behind him was walking fast, taking huge strides, and no matter how fast Kevin ran, the large man in the hockey mask didn't lose any ground. The freak now had Kevin's axe in one hand and the machete in the other, and he was going to close the gap. Kevin was giving it his all. He ran like he did on the football field, but to no avail. This monster in the hockey mask was going to catch him. Was this Jason? The special boy the head spoke of? Did I just kill his mom? Oh, fuck! Oh, fuck! Where the fuck is the cabins? Kevin's thoughts screamed. Then Kevin came into a clearing. As he ran out of the trees, he began to lose his footing. He was sliding. He almost fell, but was barely able to remain standing. He took a quick look around and realized he was on the lake. It was frozen. He noticed something else. Jason was standing on what Kevin assumed was the bank of the lake, but had stopped following Kevin. Kevin stopped and faced Jason, who was about 20 feet away. "What's wrong, Jason?" Kevin yelled. Using the name got no reaction from the giant. Jason simply put the machete back in his waistband and still held the axe in the other hand. "Wait a second. Are you shitting me? Come on, Gretzky. Are you afraid of a little ice? A little water?" Kevin teased. Maybe he would be okay after all. Jason wasn't coming out onto the lake after him. If the ice held, then maybe he would actually get away. A light snow had begun to fall. The storm was almost upon them, and he needed to find his way back to the others. "Look, dude, I had no idea that head was your, what, mom, sister, woman? Wait, were you getting head from that head? Like, were you actually..." Kevin's words were cut off as Jason reached over with his free hand and took the handle of the axe in both hands, and with an underhanded throw, lunged the axe into the air above where Kevin was standing. Kevin watched as it spun in the air above him, but his football reflexes were sharp, and he simply stepped out of the way as the axe landed with a thwack, and the blade hit and stuck into the ice next to him. It had missed by a mere foot.
"Ooh, nice try, but yeah, dude, you missed. Look, I'd love to stay and chat, but I got places to be, so just chill out," Kevin taunted.
He opened his mouth to speak again, but stopped as he saw Jason reach down and retrieve the machete from his waistband and begin to walk out onto the frozen lake. Kevin turned to run, but as soon as he took a step, the ice around his feet began to crack, coming from where the axe had hit the lake. In a panic, Kevin realized he was never the target of the axe. Jason wasn't afraid of the ice or the water. He had fallen for Jason's trap, and now it was too late. If he tried to run, he'd fall into the freezing lake. If he didn't run, Jason would do God knows what with that machete. Kevin began to slowly back away, being as careful as he could. Each tiny movement sent a new spiderweb of cracks out from below him. Even if he could move slow enough to not break the ice, it didn't matter. Jason was clearing the gap. His time was up. He had to think of something now or surely die. Kevin hoped his athleticism would save his hide. He turned and took off running, hoping he would get away from where the ice had been weakened. But even he wasn't fast enough. The spider webs of broken ice below his feet gave way when he began to run, and Kevin fell. His body plunged into icy cold darkness. The shock hit him like a freight train, and the air was knocked from his lungs. He was swallowing freezing lake water. If he didn't get to the surface, he was going to drown. He kicked his feet with all of his might, using every bit of athleticism he had in his body. His head burst from the water and he was facing the bank of the lake. Jason was nowhere to be seen. He looked left and right along the bank. He looked behind him and still nothing. He was alone, but he was freezing and the snow was falling a little harder now. He had to get out of the ice-cold water or he would freeze before he found shelter. He waded a few feet to solid ice and began trying to pull his freezing frame out of the icy depths. He heard a loud splash behind him as Jason rose from the water. He felt a large hand grabbing his hair and lifting him. Then he felt a fiery hot pain in the back of his neck. He began to scream, but the noise was cut off as the blade of Jason's machete slowly pushed through the back of Kevin's neck, through his Adam's apple, and out the front of his throat. The pain was immediate and intense. The icy shock disappeared, replaced by a panicked, burning urgency as his lungs tried to breathe as they were drowned by his pumping hot blood. Kevin thrashed in Jason's grasp like a fish flopping on land. After a few moments, the thrashing stopped. Jason pulled the machete out of Kevin's neck and let go of Kevin's hair and let him fall back into the icy waters of Crystal Lake. Jason slowly pulled himself out of the icy waters, not feeling the cold, only a hot rage. He made his way back through the woods of Crystal Lake and back to his shack. He knelt to both knees next to his mother's head. He held it, but she didn't speak. He no longer even heard his mother's voice in his head. He stared for minutes into the split eyes of his dead mother. Then he sat her down and used his machete to begin digging a hole in front of his shack. He dug with his blade and then with his hands. After he was done digging, Jason stood and walked inside the shack. Seconds later, he returned holding the tattered, worn blue sweater his mother once wore. He knelt again and picked up his mother's head and slowly wrapped it in the sweater. He then gently placed the head wrapped in the sweater inside the hole he had dug. He began to fill the hole, and when he was done, he stood again, and once again entered the shack he had shared the past 15 months with his mother. This time he was inside a little longer, collecting knives, another machete, the razor glove, and more. Somehow he knew his mother's killer was not alone. Outliers had returned to his home. He then took the candle in the back room and laid it on its side next to some old clothing and paper, and slowly exited the shack as it began to go up swiftly in flames. Jason watched the shack burn bright as the snow fell harder and harder from the dark clouds above. The unadulterated evil that was Jason Voorhees was reborn by fire in his mother's second death. He had let himself become too complacent. He had let his guard down. He had forgotten that outliers would always invade their home, would always try to hurt him and mother. He had allowed more of their kind to enter their home, and now mother was gone, physically, and he couldn't hear her voice anymore. As the shack collapsed into a fallen heap of flames and debris, Jason turned towards the Crystal Lake campgrounds. And even without his mother to speak the words to him, Jason knew what he must do. They had taken his mother away again, this time forever. And Jason would kill. He would kill them all.
Thank you.
Chapter 3, An Eye for an Eye. Outside the walls of Camp Crystal Lake, the horde of Trioxites that had been stalking the group for over 2 weeks hadn't given up, and their numbers grew as the smoke from Jason's shack burning rose into the air, attracting more of the undead. As the number of the horde pushing against the wall grew, the two trees meant to hold the wall closed began to ever so slightly move through the dirt and snow. Only a little, for now. Harry, Mark, and Janine watched Kevin heading off on a side trail away from the cabin, singing to himself, as they made their way back into the woods following the snowy trail that led to Campsite C in the Crystal Lake docks. Dad, something isn't right with this place. Tom is keeping something from us. I mean, why would they wall up such a big part of a forest and lake? Mark asked his father.
Indeed. And believe me, when we get everything settled tonight, he is going to give us some answers. I may only be a retired firefighter, but those stamps on the watchtowers that said OP-CL-JV look very much like military markings. And that graffiti, Harry began.
Camp Blood, you mean? Janine added.
Exactly, her father agreed.
And don't forget that stuff about someone they called Maggot Head rotting in hell. At the time, I was just glad we found a place to protect us from the Horde, but the more I think about that graffiti, the more I get worried that something went on here that was so bad, they walled it off, Mark said. What do you think it could be? Janine asked worriedly.
I honestly do not know, but I promise you both on your mother's grave. We will find out when we get back to the cabin, one way or another, Harry promised.
The three walked in silence for what seemed like forever, as a light snow began to fall and they came out into a clearing with what used to be a large cabin to their left, but was now a burned-out shell. To their right, they saw a large billboard that was so faded and weathered they could no longer read it. Behind it was what appeared to be a large construction site, abandoned. There was rebar and old propane canisters all around, and piles of scaffolding that seemed to have been knocked down quickly. Harry glanced around in front of them and saw a dock that was partially broken and charred, and nearby a large gas or diesel tank that had obviously exploded at some point in the past. There was also old, tattered, and faded police tape tied to some of the old scaffolding and what was left of the charred cabin. Janine put her arm around her dad's waist and hugged him close.
Dad, I'm scared. What happened here? She asked, not wanting to look anymore.
Her father responded solemnly.
I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I've seen a lot of things as a firefighter, and I know this was a gigantic explosion of some kind. It almost looks like the cabin had caught on fire and spread to the tank. But the way the dock is charred, I could almost bet someone spread an accelerant across it. Probably the fuel from that old tank. Regardless, this was most likely not a military exercise.
Harry didn't mention that he also saw multiple areas that looked like old bloodstains in the wood on the dock and by the cabin.
What the hell is this place? Mark asked.
We're gonna find out, son. It's time the senator spills the beans on this place. If we are to be staying here for a while, we need to know everything. No more letting him put it off. Let's see if we can find anything useful here and then get back, their father remarked.
After surveying the area and walking the dock that remained on the frozen lake, Harry noticed something barely visible behind the burned-down cabin, almost completely covered by trees and overgrowth. It was a small water tower. Harry hoped they had lucked out.
Kids, come with me, he barked.
The three made their way past the charred remains of the cabin and walked through the overgrowth and came upon the base of the water tower.
Harry saw a hose coming from the left side bottom of the tower. He followed it with his eyes and saw a nozzle with a turn pump handle. Harry lifted it in his hands and turned the small crank multiple times, and a small bit of water spat out of the nozzle of the hose. And then a moment later, water began to stream out of it at a surprisingly high pressure. The light snow was beginning to come down harder. Harry knew they needed to hurry. The storm was not far off now.
Mark, get the bottles out of your bag. Let's fill them up. This kind of pressure tells me this tower is pretty full. No telling how long it's been sitting in that tower. We will need to boil it, but let's take all we can carry for now. We can get more after the storm is over, Harry ordered.
Yes, sir, Mark responded, and went about taking his backpack off and unzipping it and pulling out 5 collapsed 2-liter bottles. The 3 of them filled them each up and put 3 in Mark's backpack and 2 in Janine's. Harry had hoped they would find some extra clothing, bedding, or even food, but they still hadn't completely explored the cabin they were staying in. Perhaps there would be some supplies there, and hopefully a pot they could boil the water in. The one thing he knew for sure was they weren't finding anything in the burned-down cabin, and the storm wasn't going to give them any extra time to explore the campgrounds further, this evening or night. Harry and his teenage son and daughter began their trek back to the large cabin, where the rest of their group was waiting. Jason had made his way up the bank of Crystal Lake, looking for more invaders, more outliers who had come into him and Mother's home and killed her, taken her away from Jason forever. Something told him the one he had killed was not alone, and now he knew he was right. Jason saw from a distance 3 more of them. They were filling water bottles next to the cabin and dock where he had fought the Nightmare Man, the one who had overpowered Jason in his dreams and given him one of the hardest fights of his life right here on that dock. It had taken Jason a long time to heal and regenerate after that battle. Jason had collected 2 trophies from that day. One was the glove of blades he had tied to a belt around his waist, along with several other knives before setting his shack ablaze. The other trophy was the Nightmare Man's head. A head Jason got tired of hearing talk, so he had made a large pike and placed the head atop it in the woods to forever witness Jason as the victor, and be a reminder that no one came into Jason's woods and left. As the group of 3 finished filling their bottles and zipping up their packs, Jason decided patience was more important than wrath. If there were even more outliers, then these 3 would lead him to them. So Jason watched, his rage and anger boiling. And when they began their walk away from the dock, Jason followed. Two hours had passed since Kevin and the Millers had went on their respective journeys into Crystal Lake. An evening was here and night would soon follow. The snow was starting to come down harder outside the large frosted window on the front of the cabin where Senator Tom Wilcox, Ron and Dorothy Savinsky, and the twins Adrian and Sally Ann waited. The twins were currently in the cleanest of the 3 sleeping quarters and were actively dusting and rearranging and shaking out old bedding, preparing the room for their group to have a place to camp down for the night once the fire was going in the main room. Tom and the Savinskys were chatting in the kitchen area when Ron noticed the Millers in the distance making their way back towards the cabin.
"Well, there they are. Now where is that boy with the wood? I am awfully cold," Ron complained.
The group were all dressed for winter the best they could. They were still wearing what they had on when the base had been overrun, an assortment of long johns covered by jeans, sweaters, jackets, and the like. But the temperature outside was pushing zero and was dropping by the minute. They needed the fire soon or they were going to have a serious problem.
"Honey, that boy has a name. It's Kenny," Dorothy chided her husband.
"Kevin," Tom corrected.
"Excuse me?" Ron questioned.
"It's Kevin. His name is Kevin."
The senator was cut off as Harry came charging through the front door into the main room. His face was stern and serious, and all his attention was directed straight towards the senator.
"Welcome back. Have you lot seen Kevin? He should have been back with the wood by now, surely," Ron said.
"Shut up, Ron. If you want it that bad, go get some yourself. Right now it's time for the gentleman from New Jersey to start talking. We saw the crime scene, Senator. There was police tape, evidence of an arson that caused a serious explosion. Something big went on down there, and I have a feeling it happened not long before these walls went up. What is this place? How do you know about it? And are we safe here?"
Harry demanded. Janine and Mark had walked into the cabin shortly after their father and were watching the exchange intently.
"Mr. Miller, I assure you I will explain everything, but should we not first wait for our dear friend Kevin to return with the firewood and get a nice warm fire going so we can all s—"
"No,"
Mark interjected.
"My dad asked you some questions. Quit stalling."
"I've got this handled, Mark. But he's right, Tom. The time for answers is now. We can fill Kevin in when he gets back. I'm sure he's probably just making sure we got enough wood to last through the storm. No more excuses. No more waiting. We need to know. What is this place? What is OP-CL-JV?
Harry demanded. Tom could tell his time was up. They weren't going to let him buy any more time. So he decided to answer their question. For the most part,
it stands for Operation Crystal Lake. JV is some other military jargon that would bore you. The Senate Oversight Committee, which I sat on, was briefed on some projects the military had brewing before the Trioxin fell. And when Fort Dix fell, and it looked more and more like we weren't going to get out of New Jersey anytime soon, let alone to Illinois, I shifted us in the direction of this place because I knew it had huge walls and shelter. I got us here, didn't I? We are safe from that horde, aren't we? I think that buys me some good goddamn faith, if I do say so myself," Tom snided.
"You got us here? You got us here? No, Senator, we got you here. Lots of our group died getting you here, apparently,"
Harry interjected.
"And obviously, this is a military operation. But what were they up to? What is the crime scene that my kids and I just saw? Why did the military choose this place? Talk, Tom."
Adrian and Sally Ann were in the process of cleaning the sleeping quarters and preparing it for the group when they heard the front door open and Harry speaking in a loud, authoritative voice. Then they heard him tell Ron to shut up.
"Oh, I don't want to miss this," Adrian said with a smile on her face. She then added, "The fireman is finally going to stick it to Thurston Hall and the senator. Come on, if Tom tries to bullshit anymore, we can tell them about the folder."
"Go ahead, I'm going to finish up in here. Besides, sounds like I'll be able to hear the whole thing from back here anyways. But if I miss anything, fill me in, okay?" Sally Ann responded.
"Okay, sis, but you're missing out on all the fun. Or are you just missing your secret lover?" Adrian said.
"Shut up. Now you better hurry, you'll miss the juicy parts," Sally Ann insisted.
"Fine. Your loss," Adrian said as she left the room, shut the door, and made her way to the argument that was brewing between Harry and Tom in the main room. Sally Ann was straightening up one of the twin-sized beds along the wall when she heard a slight tink at the small window on the far side of the room. She jumped, startled, but then a smile came across her face as she saw a small pebble hit the frosted snow-covered window
followed by another tink sound. Her thoughts automatically went to Kevin. Usually Kevin wouldn't be her type. She was more into a bookish guy than a jock, but at the end of the world, beggars can't be choosers, and on a run a week after the base fell, the two of them volunteered to hit an old canning factory to look for any supplies, and one thing led to another. And even though they only found a small box of canned vegetables in the whole ransacked place, they also found a new favorite pastime that took at least two people and definitely helped them stay warm during the cold winter. They began volunteering for similar runs any chance they got, but once that fucking cock-blocking horde started stalking the group, their alone time was kaput. She had wanted to volunteer to go with Kevin to get the firewood, but considering the chore at hand, thought it would be a bit too obvious, and they didn't want the whole group knowing their business. Yet. She had hoped he would hurry back so they could make some sort of excuse to be alone together. And now it looked like he was back and saw a chance for them to have a little fun. Sally Ann went to the bedroom door and locked it quietly, and then walked across the room and struggled as she opened the frosted window. Cold air immediately blasted her, sending shivers over her body. Her nipples hardened, though she wasn't sure if it was the cold or the thought of Kevin and her christening one of the beds early. The snow was falling pretty hard now, and it was pretty much dark outside. She wasn't sure of the time, but it was definitely late, and the storm was definitely close. She leaned out the window and whispered loudly,
"Kevin, is that you? Come on, we got time for a quickie if you hurry."
There was no reply. She looked left and right, but between the darkening evening and the snow, it was hard to see anything.
"Come on, Kevin. This isn't the time to be cute. Look what you're missing," she said as she slowly pulled off her thick turtleneck sweater and unfastened her bra and dropped them both to the floor, revealing her petite breast, her nipples like steel as the cold air hit her naked torso. There was still no response, and she was beginning to get irritated. She could still hear the argument from the main room, but knew time was of the essence and didn't feel like playing games right now. Not to mention she was freezing her tits off. "Okay then, guess you'll just have to wait," she said, and turned around and began to bend over to pick up her bra and sweater when she saw the room get slightly darker and sensed him standing behind her at the window.
"Oh, you've come to your senses, have you? Good, because I was beginning to think that I was going to have to take care of things myself." She didn't have time to turn around or to finish her sentence, as a large, grimy hand came from behind her outside the window and covered her mouth tightly, stifling her words or her screams, as she quickly realized that it was not Kevin's hand over her mouth or his arm that was now pulling her through the window outside into the snow. Her naked back was held against a clothed torso of a very large figure. She strained to look up, and when she did, she tried to scream again as she saw a battered hockey mask covering the face that belonged to the most evil, hateful pair of eyes she had ever seen in her life. Sally Ann fought and kicked and struggled, but it was no use. Jason had her, and to her horror, she saw Jason's other arm reaching above them both, his equally grimy free hand slowly reaching for a large icicle from the mini that hung from the gutters of the old cabin. She could only watch in terror as the large man broke off the biggest of the icicles above them and held it in his hand. He brought his hand down slowly, holding the icicle out in front of her face. She saw the sharp point of the icicle move slowly towards her left eye. She tried to move her head. She tried to scream for help, but Jason had her in a death clutch. He was too strong. She felt an icy pain spread across her eye as the point of the icicle punctured her pupil. The pain grew more intense, and she felt a large pop. And then, as the fight left her, and her struggling began to dissipate, and as she prayed for her suffering to end, she felt a searing, intense, stabbing pain, and then darkness, as her prayer was answered.
Get, 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 get.
Chapter 4, Revelations. Okay, listen. From what I understand, this campground has a sordid history. A long time ago, 1958, a kid drowned here, and then two counselors were brutally murdered, and the camp was closed down. But in 1980, it was going to be reopened, and the mother of the boy who drowned ended up being the murderer of the two counselors before. She returned to the campgrounds and killed all the counselors and the new owner of the campgrounds, Tom began. So she was arrested? Mark asked. Adrian was leaving Sally Ann to clean at this time and quietly came down the hallway and entered the room and stood against a wall, arms crossed, listening. No, one counselor survived and killed the mother in self-defense, Tom answered, and made a motion of running his thumb across his neck. Cut off her head. But soon after, all kinds of psychos started using these campgrounds as a killing field. Copycats and crazies, and the place got a bit of a reputation and became a legend in this area. Camp Blood, Janine said quietly. Yes, the town even tried changing its name, but it didn't stop the killings. So I assume the authorities got tired of it and the military stepped in and just saw this place as a good place to do exercises and stuff like that, Tom replied.
But we saw caution tape and the remains of a large explosion and a huge fire. I didn't want to tell my children this, but I saw multiple bloodstains in the wood of the dock in the cabin. Don't forget, Tom, I am a retired firefighter. That fire might not have happened super recently, but it can't have been more than a few years ago. Why would there be police tape and bloodstains put up in a military facility? Wouldn't they handle it internally? Harry asked.
Look, perhaps there was an accident and they had no choice but to include the police. I have told you what I know, Harry. I saw pictures from the exterior. I knew that they walled up the entire campgrounds and a large portion of the woods and lake, and when the Trioxin fell, I kept it all in the back of my mind, in case things at Fort Dix or Illinois didn't work out. It's not ideal to be here alone in such a small group. I'd much rather still have what's left of the military watching over us like at the base, but at least we have safety and security here. The undead are stuck outside and we are here. Let's make the best of it, yeah? Tom pleaded, hoping they would leave it at that and end their interrogation.
When this storm passes, I want us all to do a walk of the perimeter and be sure the wall is secure all the way around. Plus, we need to immediately go shore up the section of wall we came through. We need to reinforce that area first and foremost. The kids and I found a water tower down by the dock. We brought back a few liters, but I think there is enough in that tower to last a while. We can resupply as needed for now, Harry said.
He still had some questions and reservations, but felt the senator had told the extent of what he knew, so he dropped it and decided he'd make the best of it tonight, and first thing after the storm, he would go on to work, making damn sure they were all indeed truly safe. He wanted security for his kids, a place they could live in peace, and this place may very well fit that bill, he decided. He knew it had been hard on Janine and Mark having to watch their mother, his wife Allison, pulled down, attacked, and devoured by that walking skeletal humanoid trioxide that crawled from that barrel that they had found in an abandoned warehouse on their way to Fort Dix. Harry had tried to save her, but that thing that came out of that godforsaken barrel wasn't like the others he had seen. It was a monster, a corpse covered in a blackish slime, its huge eyes never closing, no lips over its huge teeth. An undead monster with a grotesque grin. It grabbed her ankle and pulled her to the ground and was biting into her before he or any of them could stop it. and then her screams had attracted nearby Trioxites, and Harry, Mark, and Janine had to hide and wait until they had finished devouring Allison and left before they could all move on. No kid should have to see their mother's life taken, let alone in such a violent, disgusting manner. And after the base fell to the Trioxites, all Harry wanted was some sense of normalcy for his kids, and damn it, he was going to make it happen for them. "It sure is coming down hard out there, isn't it? I really do wonder what is taking that boy. I'm sorry, that Kevin so long. If we don't get a fire started soon, we won't just freeze, we will be sitting in complete darkness. Unless you want to run what few batteries we have left out lighting the cabin and keeping warm with those tiny lamps of your flashlights," Ron complained again, miming a shiver. "Here, Ron, if you're so scared of the dark, you can borrow me and Sally's flashlight," Adrian muttered from behind the group, handing the flashlight to Dorothy, who handed it to her husband.
"We saw which way he went when we headed down to the dock. I didn't think he would have gone far just to chop up some wood," Harry said. "Did he say anything to anyone about what his exact plan was?" Harry asked.
"Not that I heard. He was too busy threatening me like you had about getting answers," Tom said. "I don't want to make my sister mad, but maybe Sally Ann might know something," Adrian offered from her spot against the wall.
"But why in the blazes would your sister have any idea about what Kevin..."
"Oh, I see," Ron said. "Oh, well, I think it's just fine, a couple youngsters finding a love connection at the end of the world," Dorothy added.
"Okay, any lead will do. If she doesn't know anything, then we will need to go out after him regardless of the storm. We can't just leave him out there," Harry said. "Adrian, would you mind asking Sally to come out here?"
"Of course, no problem. I'll be right back," Adrian said, and went back down the hallway towards the room her and her sister had been cleaning earlier. She came to the door and turned the knob, and realized it was locked. She knocked on it.
"Sals, hey, I think you accidentally locked the door. Open up, Kevin's not back yet, and we're getting worried," she called.
There was no answer.
"Sally Ann, you open this door now. This is no time for a nap."
Still no answer. Adrian began banging on the door. The noise drew the attention of the others, and they all joined Adrian at the bedroom door, minus Ron and Dorothy, who were still making sure the kitchen chairs didn't fly away.
"What's going on?" Harry asked.
"I don't know. The door was locked, and she's not answering," Adrian said in a slightly panicked tone.
"Do you guys feel that?" Janine asked, and put her hands up along the door frame. "There's a really cold breeze. I know it's cold as shit in here, but that's a breeze. Was there an open window?"
"No, it was closed," Adrian answered.
"Well, why in the world would she open the window?" Tom asked.
"I don't know. Sally, open the door!" Adrian yelled, banging on it.
"Watch out!" Harry barked.
Everyone backed away, and he reared back his foot and kicked hard at the strike plate. The door easily swung open from the force of Harry's kick and the old age of the wood. The room was empty. The far window was indeed open, and snow had been blowing into the room for no telling how long. It littered the floor and beds near the window. Then Adrian saw what else was on the floor: Sally Ann's sweater and bra. Adrian ran across the room to the window, sticking her head out of it.
"Sally! Kevin! Are y'all out there? This isn't funny! It's too cold!" she yelled.
"Let me shine some light on this matter," Tom said as he stepped up to the window and turned on his flashlight, shining it out into the late evening as the storm had begun to hit in full force. The snow was falling so hard that even with the flashlight lit, it was hard to see more than a couple feet ahead. He tried shining the light up, to the left, and to the right, but didn't see a thing.
until he shined the flashlight down and saw several bright red drops of what appeared to be blood atop the bright white snow, leading off into the dark and slowly being covered by the fresh powder falling from the dark sky above them. "Tell you what, let's all regroup and maybe we can think of a plan to..." Tom began to say after suddenly shutting his flashlight off at the sight of the blood, but he was cut off by Adrian.
"What is it? What did you see?" Adrian demanded.
"Nothing. Let's all go back to the main room," Tom said, while slowly walking back towards the door of the bedroom. "Here, let me look," Mark said, as he and his dad began stepping forward with Mark's flashlight and shining it out the window onto the ground, illuminating the blood. Adrian saw it and almost fell over. She wanted to scream, but her knees had failed her. She began to fall and Mark caught her.
"Dad! Tom! Help me!" Mark said.
Harry stepped forward and helped pull Adrian up. Mark shined his light around, but Tom was nowhere to be seen. Mark and Harry helped Adrian back to the main room. Janine followed.
"What in the devil was all that racket?" Ron demanded.
"Is everybody okay?" Dorothy asked.
"No, not at all," Harry barked.
Mark shined the flashlight straight at Tom, who was standing by the fireplace near the large window that ran the length of the main room.
"Where'd you go, Senator?" Mark asked.
"Start talking, Tom. What do you know? Why did you try to hide what you saw, and why the hell did you run away back in here?"
Harry demanded.
It's not possible. It's just not possible," Tom was muttering.
"What's not possible?" Janine asked. Adrian's eyes lit up and she looked up at the senator.
"His backpack, Harry! There's a folder in his backpack! Get it!" she yelled.
Harry didn't even think twice. He saw the senator's pack sitting by the fireplace a couple feet from the senator himself. He crossed the room and reached for it. Tom grabbed hold of one strap, and Harry grabbed the other.
"You won't understand, Harry," Tom said.
"Let go now, or so help me, Tom," Harry stated.
Mark turned off his flashlight and snuck up behind the senator and put him in a full Nelson, causing Tom to automatically let go of the pack. Mark turned the flashlight back on as Harry opened the pack and rummaged through it, and found a folder marked OP-CL-JV. Harry removed it from the pack. Mark stepped next to his father and took the pack. He removed his own and put Tom's across his back for safekeeping. He then shone his light onto the folder in his father's hands.
"Well, isn't this interesting?" Harry began.
Tom slowly walked to the large window and stared out at the snowstorm in defeat. Harry opened the folder. The first thing he saw was a hand-drawn sketch of the wall around Crystal Lake. He then came to a folded blueprint of what was surely the plans for the walls and watchtowers. The next thing he came to was a set of newspaper articles covering the events from Jason's drowning to Pamela's killing spree to her decapitation. He found more articles where more slayings occurred, starting with the murder of the girl, Alice, who had decapitated Pamela Voorhees after her killing spree. And in each article, the survivors claimed it was Jason Voorhees back from the dead who had killed their friends and family. There was a young boy who had supposedly killed Jason. His name was Tommy Jarvis. Then there was an article on a paramedic who had taken on the identity of Jason Voorhees in a copycat killing spree after his son had been murdered at a halfway house for troubled teens. Tommy Jarvis had been present for that series of deaths as well. Then there was articles about what witnesses say was Jason, once again back from the dead, killing a new set of counselors who had went back to work when the town had renamed itself to Forest Green and gave the camp its namesake. And yet again, there was the name Tommy Jarvis. Harry thought for a second about that graffiti they'd seen on the wall when they first got to it earlier that day. God, had it really been less than a day ago? It felt like they'd been here for days. But that graffiti, what had it said exactly?
"Rotten hell, maggot head!"
With the initials TJ. Harry was sure that TJ was Tommy Jarvis. Harry continued reading articles. A Tina Shepherd had claimed to have come against Jason years later and said Jason was surely dead. But then there were articles claiming witnesses saw a man in New York who fit Jason Voorhees' description. And a string of killings starting at Crystal Lake, which had been named back to Crystal Lake, and stretching all the way to New York. Harry leafed quickly through several pages of a mission by the FBI to try to capture Jason. And then he came to police reports and surveillance footage still images from Weston Hills Medical Center in Springwood, Ohio, that showed a large man who matched the description of Jason Voorhees over the years in all the newspaper articles as a large mountain of a man wearing a hockey mask. A string of killings began in Springwood, Ohio, and ended at Crystal Lake. There was a police report about the local PD and the county sheriff's department both responding to Crystal Lake after a large explosion and multiple murders, and this was just a few short years back. The reports continued and stated that Jason was thought to be dead when authorities responded to the explosion. And after bodies were recovered, including that of a long-dead child murderer, Fred Krueger, minus his head, which was never located, they ended up losing all officers and forensics techs on the scene, except one lone officer who got away and told the story of Jason slaying them all. And finally, Harry came to the Piece de Resistance of the entire OP-CL-JV folder. It was the plans to make Crystal Lake a large prison for Jason Voorhees. They didn't want to lose any more officers, yes, but a huge part of this plan was going to be the military and government agencies studying their prisoner, observing this Jason Voorhees and how he had survived for so many years and seemingly could regenerate over time. They had given up on trying to capture Jason and decided making him a prisoner in his own home and keeping civilians out of his home was the best way to save lives and also study what they called a freak of nature. There were several more documents, but Harry had seen enough. He closed the folder and handed it to his son, who put it back in the senator's pack. Harry turned towards Senator Tom.
OP-CL-JV? Military jargon my ass, Senator. Operation Crystal Lake Jason Voorhees, Harry said.
It's impossible. Don't you see? How could anyone believe any of that? Tom muttered.
Look around, Tom. People are missing. There's blood on the ground outside the bedroom window. The explosion and fire is mentioned in these goddamn papers, Harry stated.
Dad, what's going on? Who is Jason Voorhees? Janine asked. He's a lie made up by the military to build this place to get away with experiments, Tom said from the window. I didn't believe that supernatural nonsense then, and I don't believe it now. There is a logical explanation for all of this. The government is always lying to us. They claim to spend $5,000 on hammers, for Christ's sake, Tom pleaded, facing the group. Even Ron and Dorothy were now intrigued. What in the devil are you all on about? Ron asked from his chair.
The devil is right, Mr. Savinsky, Harry responded. Your buddy Tom here took us straight through the gates of hell and locked us in a giant cell with the devil himself, Harry answered.
Tom, I demand an explanation. I'll have you know I donated lots of money to your campaign over the years and Dorothy and I demand... Ron began before Tom cut him off. Oh my God, Ron, shut up. Money doesn't matter anymore. Have you still not figured that out? It's the end of the world, and I got all of you to a place where we are surrounded on all sides by a giant wall. We have a lake, fertile ground, trees, shelter, Tom said.
And a serial killer that can't be stopped who has killed hundreds by the looks of these stories, Harry said. A killer that even if you hurt him, he will just regenerate and keep on coming back.
Oh, for fuck's sake, Harry, regenerate? Do you hear yourself? It's all military misdirection to waste money while they play with toys. For the last time, there is no Jason Voorhees. It just isn't possible.
Before Tom could finish his rant, he was cut off by a loud crashing noise as the large window at the front of the cabin behind him exploded into broken glass and something landed in the floor in front of the fireplace. Mark shined the light down to see the topless body of Sally Ann with a huge gaping bloody hole where her left eye used to be. Adrian immediately screamed and fell at her dead sister's side crying. Mark shined the light up at the window and the entire group saw him now. Jason Voorhees stood tall, his weathered hockey mask glowing in the light of the flashlight, his hatred and fury radiating from his eyes that stared at them all in bloodlust. Steam rose off of his clothing as he began to climb through the window into the cabin. Chaos ensued. The two chairs that Ron and Dorothy had been holding down all evening finally found themselves empty as the older couple opened the front door a few feet away from them and ran for their lives into the negative zero temperature of the snowstorm that was pummeling Camp Crystal Lake. Harry grabbed his son and daughter's hands and yanked them backwards and out the back door. They took a sharp left into the snowy darkness. Senator Tom turned on his flashlight and shone it on Jason. He still could not believe it was all true. He only kept it a secret from everyone because he didn't want the group to fall for the bullshit and give up a good thing and choose to leave the safety of the walls around Crystal Lake. It couldn't be true. It wasn't possible. It was like Roswell in Area 51, conspiracy bullshit. But now Tom was facing this conspiracy bullshit, and it was flesh and blood, and it was staring at him. The only thing between Jason and Tom was Sally Ann's corpse and her twin sister Adrian, who was kneeling beside her, holding her hand, trying to wake her up as if she didn't have a massive hole in her head. Tom backed up slowly and almost fell out the back door. He finally snapped into survival mode and went down the back stairs into the snow. He ran to the right, but in his panic, had forgotten what his chore had been earlier that very evening. He had offered to dig the latrine pit, and dig it he had, 3 feet deep and 4 foot by 4 foot circumference. And with the snow falling so hard and fear pulsing through his body, he didn't think for a second about the pit and stepped right into it, snapping his ankle to the side so hard his leg bone broke through the skin and he fell into the latrine pit on his side. The pain exploded in his leg and rose. He vomited immediately. He tried to pull himself up, but the moment he moved his leg, the pain hit him again, harder, and he fell over onto his back and everything went dark as he passed out. Jason watched as the people in the cabin ran off into the night in different directions. No matter, they were in his home, and he would find them all and he would kill them all. For himself, for Mother. Jason looked down at the exact copy of his last kill, except this one was wearing all her clothes. Jason cocked his head to one side. He had seen twins before, he had killed twins before, but this girl knew he was standing behind her, and she wasn't running, she wasn't screaming, she was holding the dead hand of Jason's last victim, and was crying. If she expected mercy, there would be none.
Sally Ann, I can't do this without you. I can't. Wonder Twins, remember?
Adrian cried as she spoke softly, harkening back to their childhood days when they would call upon the power of the Wonder Twins as they ran around their yard and played the summers and evenings away. But their running days were now over. Sally Ann was gone. Adrian knew that now and she felt defeated. Her will to run and save her own life was gone.
without her parents, without her twin sister who she considered her other half. What was the point? She bent over and kissed her sister on the cheek and said, "Goodbye." Jason had seen enough. He reached down and took hold of Adrian's red hair and pulled her to her feet. He spun her around to face him. He stared deep into her eyes in the darkening room as snow blew in from outside. Jason eyed something near them hanging high next to the fireplace. It was the mounted head of a large buck deer with a huge 14-point rack. Jason sent all of his rage and anger through his eyes into Adrian's, and though she had lost the will to live, lost the will to fight, lost the will to run, she was suddenly filled with fear like she had never felt in her life. Her leg and pants became wet as her urine let go. Her body shook. Her eyes were locked with Jason's, and as much as she wanted to be brave, all she felt was fear. Not fear of death, but just pure, unfiltered fear. She still felt the fear as Jason took her by her shoulders and hoisted her into the air. She felt the fear as pain exploded through her back and chest. She felt the fear as Jason let go of her, but she still seemed to be held 3 feet off the floor. She felt the fear as she looked down and saw the horns of a deer protruding through her chest and blood pouring to the floor. She felt the fear as her lungs filled with that blood and breathing became harder and harder to accomplish. She felt the fear as she watched Jason walking away from her into the darkness towards the back door. And she felt the fear as everything in her vision seemed to get further and further away. And she felt the fear as darkness engulfed her. And then she feared no more. Chapter 5. Frozen Stiff. Senator Tom Wilcox was awoken from his pain-induced sleep by the sound of heavy footsteps striking a wooden floor, and it was close. Tom couldn't think clearly from the pain that radiated from his broken ankle and exposed bone. The sub-zero temperature in the snow he lay in had alleviated some of the pain. How long had he been out? Where was Jason? The impossible freak of nature who shouldn't have existed. Tom still couldn't believe what he saw. Why did he have to be so arrogant? Part of him had to know that there was something to the legend of Jason Voorhees. Part of him had to have known the military would not have constructed this wall around this area simply for military exercising and testing out new toys. But Tom was a know-it-all, always had been. He was stubborn, and all he had thought about since the Trioxin fell was his own safety, his own security. He took several top-secret documents, all of which had information on military projects around the country that included a safe zone of sorts, like the walled-off Camp Crystal Lake Campgrounds and surrounding area. He was so preoccupied with making sure his own hide was safe that he didn't listen to any gut feelings or instincts of danger. And now here he was, laying in a 3-foot hole, and if he didn't think fast and find some way out of his predicament, then he may have very well dug his own grave and laid down in it. Tom rummaged around his body, wincing in pain at every slight movement that caused any vibration down his leg. His hands dug around searching the snow for his flashlight, the thing he needed most right now. And just when he had almost given up on finding it, his almost numb fingers brushed against it, and he grabbed hold of it and pulled it to his chest. He took a deep breath and clicked on the light. The first thing he did was shine it down at his feet and examine his broken ankle. He almost vomited again at the sight of it, the bone protruding from it, and his booted foot laying at an impossible angle. He could see blood in the white snow around it. His pain and anguish almost made him forget the most important problem he now faced. He hoped and prayed he was alone. He painfully struggled to pull himself up on his left elbow. It was just enough to see over the hole, and he quickly shined the flashlight at the back of the cabin. All he saw was thick falling snow in the dark, and he could barely make out the open back door of the cabin, but there was no giant man in a hockey mask to be seen.
Had he not seen me? Did he go after the others? Tom thought to himself.
He shined his light around him as much as he could without fully sitting up and turning his body, and causing more pain to reverberate up his leg. He was keeping as still as possible. Every slight movement was agony that rose from his exposed bone all the way up to the top of his head, and he couldn't afford to pass out again. Not in this weather. He needed to get inside. Even without a fire, he would be safer and have a better shot at survival inside. He needed a tourniquet, and soon. Tom gently let himself lay back down and pulled the flashlight to his chest again. He took a careful but deep breath of cold air and looked straight up towards the dark sky, camouflaged by the litany of snowfall that would almost be beautiful if not for his current situation. Tom closed his eyes, taking another careful deep breath and preparing himself for his crawl to shelter. He was lucky that the monster had gone after the others, and he wasn't going to waste his shot at survival. He wasn't going to survive the goddamn apocalypse to die here in a freshly dug shit pit because of a broken ankle and hypothermia. He was a fucking United States Senator after all. Tom steadied himself, willed himself to be ready for the pain that would surely follow his rolling over and crawling. He opened his eyes and realized he hadn't actually been lucky. The worst case scenario was here. Jason hadn't followed the others after all. Standing at the top of the pit, staring down at Tom in the snowfall and darkness, was a large, tall, dark figure, too big to be anyone from his group. Tom's hands began to shake as he gingerly pointed his flashlight up at the figure, and was flooded with intense fear when he saw Jason Voorhees, the impossible monster. He was staring down at Tom, and through the battered hockey mask, Tom could see two eyes that may as well have been burning fire. Jason was projecting hatred, bloodlust, and wrath in those eyes, and it chilled Tom to the bone in a way not even the sub-zero temperatures and his body trying to go into shock could. Tom had nowhere to go. He couldn't run. He was literally boxed in by this unstoppable killing machine. The only thing Tom could think to do was what he did best, and then Tom gave it his best shot.
Jason, wait. Listen, I am a United States Senator. I know what they've done to you, and I want to help you, Tom began while trying to hide his intense fear. My name is Thomas Matthews. I am still a powerful man. I can get you anything you want. I know your story. I know what those counselors did to your mom. And I know you don't want people in your home, but the world has changed.
Jason stood and watched as the man in the hole before him blathered and begged like so many before. Jason longed to hear his mother's voice in his head guiding him, drowning out the whimpering ramblings of his victims, and being the driving force behind his murderous impulses. He longed for his mother at all. He had no idea why her voice was gone. Even before her head had started talking to him again, he was still able to hear her voice at all times. Why had her voice gone away after that boy took her away from him forever? Jason had no way of knowing that he was dealing with stages of grief. It was all so new to him, he had no way to process his pain. He would never feel what humans felt in these situations, but it didn't change the fact that he was grieving for the loss of his mother. And his pain and anger was being amplified by his frustration of true isolation. Even in all his years alone at Crystal Lake, he still could at least hear Mother. But now he walked and killed alone. The kills didn't bring her back. They didn't make him feel any less frustrated. But it was all he knew. There was only he and Mother. Everyone else only wanted to hurt them. And they had to die. Still, Jason stood staring down at the man in the hole. And he continued to hope that at any moment, he would hear his mother again, and everything would be right. The dead are walking the earth and killing the living, Jason. But even in all the chaos, look what I achieved. I took a group of people that would surely be dead outside of these walls. And I, single-handedly, through my knowledge and my authority as a senator, was able to bring them all to safety here, behind walls that keep the dead out. Think of that, Jason. I did that. I brought them here, me, and I can do anything for you. Just tell me what you want.
Jason, still hoping his mother would speak to him, was staring down at the man in the hole and barely hearing what he blathered on about. But Jason definitely heard what the man had just said. This man before Jason brought these people here. This man before Jason brought the boy here who had taken mother away from him forever. This man was the reason that mother was wrapped in her sweater and buried in the cold frozen ground of Camp Crystal Lake and silenced. It was this man who killed mother. He was the one to blame for Jason not being able to even hear mother anymore, and he would pay. Jason would avenge his mother, and in that moment Jason looked back at the back door of the cabin, and through the heavy snow he was still able to see something leaning against the wall of it. Jason turned and walked away from the hole.
Oh my God, thank you. Yes, yes, I won't forget this. Remember, anything you want, it's yours,
Tom said, thinking that Jason was going to leave him and give him a chance to get inside. He didn't press his luck in asking for a hand out of the hole, so Tom pulled himself up on his elbows again, preparing to embark on what would surely be a torturous journey back to the cabin. He struggled to see through the dark and snow, but could make out Jason walking towards the cabin's back door and stopping. He thought he saw Jason reaching for something by the back door. Tom's heart dropped when he remembered that he himself had put the shovel there when he finished digging the pit he now lay in. He watched in terror as Jason picked it up and turned back towards the hole and began slowly walking back to where Tom lay.
Please! Jason, trust me. I can give you anything you want. What do you want? Oh God, please just tell me,
Tom pleaded. What Jason wanted was to hear his mother again, and just as badly Jason wanted this man to feel he and mother's pain. So indeed, Tom would give Jason exactly what he wanted. Jason held the shovel shaft in both hands and stepped slowly into the hole, standing straddle over Tom. Jason lifted the shovel as high as his arms would reach above him.
Oh, Jesus, no! Please! No!
Tom screamed, but Jason was through listening. He had heard enough. Jason brought the shovel down with ungodly force, and the blade of the shovel slammed into Tom's midsection. Tom felt a piercing, cold, sharp pain as the shovel pushed into his guts. And then for a brief moment, Tom felt a shockwave throughout his entire body, followed by a loud snap and crack as the shovel broke through his spine. And then Tom felt nothing. Tom was still alive, but could feel nothing. He couldn't move a muscle. All he could do was lay there, staring up into the falling snow and at the giant man staring down at him through his hockey mask that was now splashed with a streak of crimson. He saw Jason still holding the shaft of the shovel. He watched as Jason pulled up on the shovel in a fast motion, and he could see his intestines and guts rising out of his body as he did so. And he watched in fascinated horror as Jason stepped out of the pit and used the shovel, that was now painted in Tom's own blood and gore, to begin filling the hole back in. The only thing Tom could feel was the blood that was running out of his mouth, and then the dirt and rocks hitting his face. And he had to watch as Jason took shovelful by shovelful of dirt and tossed it onto Tom's body. The dirt began to cover Tom's eyes, and the last thing he saw before Jason threw a shovelful of dirt that covered his eyes completely was the falling snow, and somehow, even in the darkness, he could see Jason's eyes, the embodiment of hatred and anger. After that, Tom lay in a grave dug by his own hands, and slowly suffocated and bled out as the snow covered the icy cold ground of Crystal Lake, that, like Pamela Voorhees before him, would forever
be his tomb. Jason finished filling in the hole and drove the shovel into the snowy ground next to it. Mother still wasn't talking, but Jason knew she would be proud of her special, special boy, and he knew what she would want him to do, and he intended on doing just that. Jason walked back into the cabin, past the corpse hanging on the wall, then he stepped over the corpse lying in the floor, and walked through the open front door of the cabin. He looked down at the snow-covered ground and could still see two sets of tracks made by the man and woman who ran out of the cabin when he had made his presence known. The falling snow was quickly covering the tracks, but Jason had no doubt that he would find them. And even if he couldn't hear it, he knew that Mother would soon be pleased. Harry, Mark, and Janine ran through the snowstorm into the vast woods of Camp Crystal Lake. They had no idea where they were going, but Harry knew he had to get his children as far away from Jason as possible. He had to also find some sort of shelter for them until the storm passed. As soon as it did, he would find a way to get them out of this snowy prison. He knew they had a better chance back on the outside facing the undead than they did being hunted by a force of nature like Jason. His children were all that mattered, and as horrible as it sounded, he hoped that Jason might be busy with Tom the Senator or the Monopoly Man and his trophy wife, and that Harry and his kids would put enough distance between themselves and Jason and have a real chance at escaping. They ran and ran, sucking in icy cold air and never looking back. At one point, Harry thought he heard an echo of what sounded like a man screaming, but he ignored it and kept moving. The woods were thick, the snow was deep, and the storm was not letting up anytime soon. But they ran with everything they had. When he thought they had ran enough, he pushed them to run some more. Everything was disorienting. Janine on his left, Mark on his right, he held their hands tightly and ran at their pace, urging them on. And just when they thought their lungs might actually explode, the snowfall in the darkness turned into a wall made of logs, and they had to come to a screeching stop or else collide with the small boathouse they had inadvertently ran to. They all stood catching their breath, looking around and praying they were alone. "Dad, I can't run anymore," Janine said breathlessly.
I don't think he followed," Mark added, also out of breath.
Harry had not let go of their hands and began to walk around the small building, pulling them with him.
"Dad, I need a minute to..." Janine began.
Harry looked at her, let go of her hand, nodded at her, and placed a finger over his lips in a shushing gesture, and then did the same towards Mark. He then took Janine's hand again. He walked them to the front of the small boathouse and tried the doorknob. It turned and opened with a slight squeak. They all walked inside, and he finally let go of both their hands. Mark turned on his flashlight and shone it around the room as Harry shut the door behind them, standing vigilantly, staring out the small square glass window of the door. Mark's light revealed a stack of three canoes covered in a large blue tarp tied with nylon roping, and the rest of the room was completely empty, save for cobwebs and dust. The walls on each side of the door had a medium-sized window that were frosted over almost completely. After several minutes of silence and confident they were truly alone, Harry turned to his kids, looked at them solemnly, then reached for Mark's flashlight. His son handed it over without question. Harry paced the small area for a long moment, and then began untying the rope and taking the tarp down off of the canoes. He set the tarp to the side and motioned for Mark to come over and help him move the canoes. Harry and Mark positioned them in front of the door. Even inside the building, it was deathly cold, and the wind howled outside as the snow continued to fall hard onto the ground. Harry dragged the tarp over against the back wall and motioned for his two kids to join him as he sat down facing the door. They sat on either side of their father. He pulled the tarp up and wrapped it around all three of them as tightly as he possibly could. He could feel his teens shivering and felt intense frustration that he couldn't fix things for them. He couldn't get them out of this godforsaken place. He couldn't give them a warm fire. He couldn't give them safety and security. All he could do was be there with them and hope they weren't found by Jason, and that in the morning, if the storm has passed, that they would find a safe way out of this monster's prison. Beneath the large tarp, he put his arms around Mark and Janine, who both laid their heads over onto his shoulders. They sat in silence for a long time, and eventually Janine and Mark fell asleep. Harry did not sleep. He would stay up the entire night watching the door, hoping he would have a chance to save his family, hoping he would at the very least get them out of this place alive. He had a horrible feeling deep in his gut, but he pushed it even further down and ignored it. He was going to protect his kids at all costs. After Sally Ann's body had crashed through the window of the cabin, and Ron and Dorothy Savinsky had seen the monster in the hockey mask begin to climb through that very window, they made their move. They had lived far too long to go out at the hands of the hockey mask-wearing sicko before them. They had been sitting in two old chairs all afternoon and evening that just so happened to be a few feet from the front door of the cabin. The snowstorm was in full effect, and darkness had fallen over the camp. But if they were anything, they were good snoopers. They heard everything. They were always listening. They had seen Harry and his two teens go straight out of the cabin onto a trail that Harry had later reported led to a burned-down cabin and a dock. Perhaps there were more cabins, some type of structure they could hide in. They hadn't seen it yet, but maybe the lake wasn't completely frozen and they could find a boat of some kind, perhaps a canoe, and get as far away from that monster as possible. They were much older than most in their group, and they knew if they stuck around they would surely be the first on the chopping block. All they had to do was run straight out of the cabin, find the trail, and keep moving. The problem was they were running in snowfall that was coming down so hard and thick that they couldn't see more than a foot in front of them, even with the flashlight that Adrian had handed them shortly before all hell broke loose. They had been running for several minutes and should have hit the trail much sooner than now, but had only found themselves in dense woods. They had surely missed the trail due to the storm and now had no sense of where they were going. They had begun to slow down. Dorothy was not an athletic person at all, and Ron was in his 60s and out of shape, and his blood pressure was spiking. He could feel it, and above all else, they were freezing. The temperature was below zero. The wind was howling through the trees, blowing the freshly fallen snow all over the place and sending the couple into a disoriented daze. As they moved at a slow run, they were both haunted by the echo of a man screaming. It seemed to come from all around them, and then once again, all they could hear was the howling of the wind and their own labored breathing.
"Ron, who was that? What are we going to do? Where are we?" Dorothy pleaded.
"It could have been the storm. Don't let your mind go there. I don't know where we are. Don't you think I'm just as lost as you are?" Ron snorted.
"I'm sorry. I'm just scared, dear. Where is the trail?" Dorothy asked.
"I'm sorry, love. We missed the trail a while back. But if we just keep going straight, we should come out to where Harry mentioned earlier. And with any luck, we will find shelter or perhaps a means of escape or defending ourselves," Dorothy's husband said, wincing and breathing much harder than even he should be after running so hard.
"Your blood pressure! Ron, where is your pack? We need your pills," Dorothy said, panicked.
"I
didn't have time to grab it, he began out of breath. It happened too fast. Let's keep moving. I'll be okay, Ron insisted. But he knew deep down his blood pressure was rising to critical levels, and they needed to find warmth and shelter fast. The two continued their swift pace for what seemed like an agonizing eternity to Ron, before coming out of the trees and almost running into a small water tower. Ron leaned against one of the legs of the tower and collapsed to a sitting position. Dorothy ran to his side.
Ron, we made it. It's the water tower Harry spoke of. There should be a burned cabin and a dock nearby. Maybe the lake isn't completely frozen and we can get away from this area, Dorothy said.
Dorothy, I don't think I can get back up right now. It's cold, and I'm tired, Ron said, struggling to form his words as his blood pressure threatened to send him into a stroke.
Honey, if we stay here, we are going to freeze to death. Let me help you up, Dorothy insisted.
Just go, Dorothy. I am only hold you back now, Ron said.
What do you mean? You're not making any sense, darling. Look at me, Dorothy demanded, taking the flashlight from Ron and shining it into his eyes.
One of his pupils pinned, while the other was completely unresponsive. He was staring ahead in a stupor, his mouth moving without forming any words.
Ron, you can't leave me! Get up! We have to go!
Dorothy stopped mid-shout as she saw the large man in the hockey mask come into the clearing behind Ron, machete in his hand at the ready. The snow was so thick, but still she could see he was glaring right into her eyes, and she grabbed Ron by his shoulders, attempting to pull him up.
Ron, he's here! Get up!
Ron could hear his wife clearly. He was trying with everything he had to overcome his body's attack. When he heard that Jason was there, every fiber of his being went into action to protect his wife, and he slowly pulled himself up by his right arm, finding that his left arm had failed him. With his wife's help, he got to his feet and turned to face their stalker. With his left side against the leg of the tower, he looked at his wife, placed his right hand on her collarbone, and said,
I'm sorry. I love you.
Now go, damn it, run! And shoved her with what strength he had left. She was not expecting this and stumbled and fell to her hands and knees as Ron once again turned his attention to Jason.
Leave her alone! Take me, you bastard! Come on, you fucking goon! Give me all you got!
Well, do it already!
Ron shouted with all he had. But what actually came out sounded to Jason and Dorothy like,
Leave her alone! Tell Master Fagoon! Give me God! Give me God! Re-ba-doog!
Jason stared down the small man in front of him and noticed as the man spoke nonsense, his face began to droop on one side and his pants darkened at his crotch. And a stench rose off of him. Jason rose his machete high, but before he could swing it, the man fell dead at Jason's feet. Jason cocked his head to one side, staring down at the man in confusion. Jason's confusion soon turned to rage when the realization hit him that the man laying before him had escaped his wrath. In a fit of rage, Jason brought his machete down anyways, severing the head of the small man laying on the ground before him. Dorothy, still on her hands and knees in the snow, had watched in horror as her husband had a massive stroke. She could tell he had tried his best to defend her, but the shock of his stroke and immediate death, followed by the monster decapitating his corpse and his blood oozing from his neck and causing steam to rise as it melted the snow, froze Dorothy in place. She may have been able to put distance between herself and Jason if she had done what her husband had said and ran. But now Jason was once again staring at her. She started to stand to run.
No, please, no!
She screamed. Jason took one massive step forward and swung his machete down, slicing into the back of Dorothy's ankles as she tried to stand, severing both of her Achilles tendons in one swipe. Dorothy felt the pain explode from her ankle and rise like a shockwave of fire through her body. She could not stand, could not walk, let alone run, so she did the only thing she could do and began pulling herself through the snow, crawling away from Jason at a snail's pace. She kept waiting for that machete to swing down once again and reunite her with her husband Ron, but it never came. She continued to crawl, not getting far fast, but no machete came. Instead, she began hearing a strange cranking noise. It got louder and faster. She turned her head back and saw Jason holding a nozzle connected to a hose, and he was turning a small hand crank that was pumping water from the tower into the hose. Dorothy tried to crawl faster. The wind howled, the snow fell, and the temperature dropped. Jason stood behind the crawling woman and squeezed the handle of the now primed water hose. A strong stream of ice-cold water sprayed out of the nozzle, drenching the woman on the ground in front of Jason. She was drenched from head to toe by the time the water in the hose froze from the sub-zero temperature, and the pressure subsided. As the hose became useless, Jason watched as the woman continued to crawl, but was slowing by the second. Dorothy felt the ice-cold water drench her clothes, hair, and body. The howling winds and sub-zero temperature began to freeze the water into a layer of ice around her body. The ice around her fingers cracked as she continued to try to crawl, but she was slowly freezing to death. As she tried to move, her fingers extended once more to try to pull herself forward, but they would not close again. She lay in a layer of ice. Her heart began to beat slower in her chest. Her lungs fought to pull in breath. Confusion rattled her brain. The only warmth she felt was the tears she began to sob. And even they failed her, as they also began to freeze and turn to crystals on her cheeks. Then an odd peace came over her as she began to fall into unconsciousness. But before her eyes could close forever, Jason took another massive step forward, lifting his boot into the air above her head. And as she looked up in terror, he brought it down with all of his strength, crushing her skull and sending hot blood and brain matter into the fresh snow. Dorothy had been reunited with Ron, and Jason was almost done with his work. Chapter 6, The End of the World. The snowstorm passed and the sun had risen on the gigantic horde of Trioxites attempting to push their way into Crystal Lake. Dozens of the undead stood frozen in place, unable to move from the storm that had finally passed. Others were covered in ice and snow, but their numbers were so massive, they had made enough headway that the section of wall had opened to the point that the closest undead's flesh was slowly ripped from its skeletal frame as it was squished through the small opening. Within minutes, the opening was large enough that they all began squeezing through one by one as the horde en masse continued to push, making the opening wider and allowing more and more through. The horde had finally found their way into the large prison made for one. Daylight poured through the frosted windows of the boathouse. Harry had watched the door all night. He saw the snow stop falling 2 hours ago, and he knew time was not on their side. They needed to find a safe way out of the Crystal Lake campgrounds. he gently roused his sleeping teens awake.
Listen, kids. The sun is up and the storm has passed. We have to find a way out of this place, and it's not going to be easy. There's no way that horde has moved on from where we came in at. They haven't given up on us since they started following us weeks ago. We need to find a damaged section of wall or a place to climb. We'll take this rope. It isn't much. Nowhere close to long enough to climb the wall, but we can look for more. There has to be more structures. We need to find more rope or anything like it, but we need to move quickly and carefully, Harry explained.
I need some water and I'm hungry, Janine said. Here, I've got a few granola bars left, and I know we didn't boil it, but I got the water from yesterday, Mark said, as he took his pack off and pulled it in front of him and unzipped it. To his dismay, he saw only folders, batteries, and two small bags of out-of-date, surely stale potato chips. And he remembered he had left his pack behind in the cabin after the chaos, and he was holding on to the senator's bag for safekeeping. Oh, crap. I left my bag back at the cabin. I've still got the senator's, Mark continued. But here's some old chips. At least it's something. Sorry, no water. It's okay, I have two bottles in my bag, Janine replied, pulling her pack off and opening it. She unzipped it and pulled out one of the bottles of water and opened the cap. Before she could take a drink, her dad reached over and took the bottle from her.
Wait, I'll try it first, he said protectively.
Harry was unsure of the quality of the water from the tower, but was also unsure about melting or eating the snow. Even so long after the trioxin fell, he wasn't confident in what remained in the atmosphere or how it might affect humans. He would prefer to be able to melt and boil the snow or boil the water he now held in his hands. But they didn't have that option, and they needed hydration. So he pulled it to his nose and smelled it, and found it had no odor of any kind. He took a swig. It tasted fine. He handed it back to his daughter.
Don't drink too much, just enough to hydrate. I will try to find us a way to boil it as soon as possible.
The three Millers each drank some of the water and shared the two bags of chips. Harry found one granola bar in his pack and split it between Mark and Janine. They insisted he have some as well, but he told them he was fine. Mark offered to carry the pack with the remaining 2 liters of water, allowing his younger sister to carry the much lighter pack of Senator Tom's. Harry and Mark moved the canoes from the door.
Come here, both of you, Harry said.
Janine and Mark walked to their father, who embraced them both in a huge hug. He held the back of their heads and leaned his head down first to kiss the top of the head of his son and then his daughters.
I love you both. We're going to make it. I think we got far enough away that he didn't follow or doesn't know where we are. We'll keep moving in the same direction as last night. We're gonna find a way out, all of us. I won't let anything happen to you, he said, trying to reassure his visibly scared teens.
We know you won't, Dad, Mark said.
I know, Daddy. I love you too, Janine added.
Harry opened the door to the boathouse and was almost blinded by the bright sun that was reflecting off the fresh snow-covered ground before them. After their eyes adjusted, the family of three held hands and began trekking through the woods of Crystal Lake, finding their way to the walled exterior of the campgrounds, and hopefully a way out. Harry was ever vigilant, constantly keeping an eye on their surroundings, ensuring they weren't being stalked by the monster that had killed Sally Ann and most likely Kevin. Harry wasn't sure who remained of their group or whose scream he had heard the night before. But the only ones that mattered at all to him were the ones he now held the hands of, his children. Everyone else can fend for themselves, he decided. As they walked in silence, Harry marveled at just how beautiful this deadly place was. He hoped that someday soon he could find a place like this for him and his children to stay and survive, minus the homicidal monster. I was thinking, if we could find some sturdy vines, we could fashion them into a sort of rope for climbing as well, Mark stated, breaking the silence.
That's a pretty good idea, son. There's surely plenty. Let's keep an eye out,
his dad proudly stated. Also, I was thinking that maybe we could find some sort of axe, or maybe even a tree that has already fallen, and we could... A whoosh could be heard, and then a sickening thwack, and Mark seemed to stop mid-sentence, before continuing his idea in slow, slurred verbiage.
Climb. Climb. We could...
As Mark struggled to say his words, Janine turned to see what was wrong. She had been looking at the ground as they walked, lost in her own thoughts, and as she turned her attention to her brother, the first thing she saw was steaming drops of bright red crimson stains in the snow at her brother's feet. Her eyes quickly darted up, and she screamed at the sight of a large wooden handle of a hunting knife protruding from her brother's face directly between his eyes.
Climb, climb, out.
Mark finished mumbling as he released his father's hand and dropped to his knees and fell face first dead into the snow, driving the hunting knife deeper into his skull, the point of which now protruded from the back of his head.
Mark! Son!
Harry yelled in disbelief. He dropped to the ground and rolled his son over, his shaking hand reaching for, but daring not to touch the handle of the knife.
Oh, no! No, Mark! Oh, God!
Dad! Janine screamed, pointing to the trees in front of them. Tears streaking down his face, Harry, now on his knees in the snow, held his dead son in a hug. Janine's scream snapped Harry out of his shock. He rose his eyes to look to where his daughter pointed and saw the monster from the night before, Jason Voorhees, moving fast through the woods heading straight for them. He was still a good distance away, but would catch up to them quickly. Harry thought of Janine and refused to lose her as well. He quickly kissed the top of Mark's head one last time and laid him down in the snow, rose to his feet, grabbed Janine's hand, and they ran back in the direction they had come. Jason saw them run. He had hunted all night for them, and now he had them in his sights. Only two remained now. Soon his mother would be avenged. Part of Jason still held out hope her voice would return to him if he killed them all. His frustration and rage was higher than ever before. He moved quickly through the snow, almost running after his prey. He would see his work completed. Harry and Janine ran as fast as they could, both in disbelief that Mark was gone. As he ran, Harry thought back to bringing Mark home from the hospital, seeing him walk for the first time, his first words, teaching him to swim, dropping him off on his first day of school. The shock was extreme. His heart was shattered, his tears almost freezing to his cheeks in the blistering cold. As he started to feel himself losing the will to continue, he again looked over at his daughter, terror etched across her face, and she again snapped him out of it. He had to protect his daughter. Even if he had to die for her, then damn it, that's what he would do. She would survive. She would go on. No matter what it took, Janine would not suffer the fate of her brother. And even if Jason did catch up, he would hold him off long enough for her to... Harry's thoughts were instantly stopped as his foot crunched through the deep snow and landed on something that was not the ground. There was a loud metallic click, and then a sickening wet thwop of metallic teeth snapping into flesh, meat, and bone, and Harry screamed in agony as he was stopped in place. He immediately let go of his daughter's hand, dropped to one knee, and began moving snow away from his trapped ankle. He felt dread and defeat when he saw the blood and gore caused by what had stopped his retreat.
Ah! It's a bear trap! Harry shrieked.
Dad, no! Janine screamed and stopped running and dropped to the ground, fumbling with the trap, trying in vain to help her dad break free. Harry was also trying to pull on the trap and pull himself free. Each touch sent pain coursing through his body. He looked behind them and saw Jason in the distance, still moving swiftly in their direction.
Janine, there's no time. You have to go, he ordered.
No, Dad. I can't leave you. I can't make... I need you, she cried, fresh hot tears pouring down her cheeks as the realization hit her that she would soon be all alone.
Listen, you are strong. You will make it. You will survive this world. I love you. Don't give up. Now run!
Harry said, while giving his daughter a quick hug and pushing her away, turning to face the large killer, now much closer than before.
Dad! Daddy, I love you!
Janine said, wrestling with the guilt of leaving her dad behind. There was nothing she could do to stop what was coming. Jason Voorhees was now only 10 feet away, and her father turned his head back around to look at his daughter, and mouthed the word run, before turning his attention back to his stalker. Janine saw Jason raise his machete into the air, mid-stride, now only a few feet away from her father. Janine turned her head and ran with everything she had. She could hear her dad yelling, and then heard her dad scream. And then she heard nothing but her own heavy breathing and the pounding of her heart in her ears. She never turned back around. She didn't want to see. She would do what her father said. She would not give up. She would survive. After what seemed like several minutes had passed and Janine still ran, she chanced a glance over her shoulders, and to her surprise, she could not see the giant killer behind her. She began to panic, looking all around her. Where was he? Was he still following her? Adrenaline coursed through her veins, shielding her temporarily from the grief and the anguish and pain of losing what remained of her family. As a million possibilities ran through her head as she made her way through the thick woods, she turned her head back straight forward and almost ran directly into Jason, who was standing between two large trees directly in Janine's path, and he had his machete held over his head at the ready to strike her down. Instinctively, she went into a baseball slide on the ground next to where Jason stood. She could feel the air of the whoosh of the machete as Jason brought it down, barely missing its mark. Janine backed up to the closest tree and pulled herself to her feet. Jason was so close to her and was standing up from his missed swing. He snapped his body around facing her and swung his machete straight down. Janine screamed and let her body drop dead weight to the ground on her ass. The machete again missed her by mere inches, embedding itself into the tree. Jason pulled at it, trying to unstick it. Janine reared back her right leg, bending at the knee, and extended it into a swift kick, her foot crashing into the crotch of Jason Voorhees with every bit of force she could muster. Jason was caught off guard, but it did not seem to faze him as much as she had hoped. He released his machete and reached down towards Janine, and his massive hands wrapped around her small throat. He lifted her into the air and began to squeeze. Janine's hands went to her throat, trying to pry the monster's fingers loose, but it was no use. He was far too powerful. Jason glared at Janine through the eye holes of his blood-stained hockey mask. She could see pure fury and rage in his eyes, and it chilled her to the bone. Seconds felt like hours. She didn't have much time before her life would be snuffed out. Her hands dropped from his fingers and she began grabbing at his body, scratching and punching to no effect. And then her hand came across a belt around his waist, and she felt something hanging from it. It felt like a glove. She ran her fingers over it and winced as a blade cut her finger. Janine, in pure survival mode, yanked the glove off of Jason's belt, looked down at it as she began to see stars from lack of oxygen. She forced her hand into the glove and lifted her hand with her last bit of strength, extending a single finger blade, and drove it into Jason's left eye. Jason instantly released Janine, her hand coming out of the glove as she fell to the ground on her side, coughing and hacking, sucking in ice-cold air trying to refill her lungs. She looked up and saw Jason reaching for the glove that now hung from the front of his mask, one finger blade sticking through the eye hole of it, deep into his eye socket. Blood poured and gushed from the eye hole onto the hockey mask as Jason forcefully grabbed the glove and yanked it free. The eyeball coming free from the eye socket, still impaled by the blade affixed to the finger of the glove. Janine took her opportunity and crawled away quickly, stood and ran. Behind her, Jason, more furious than ever, threw the glove and his eye to the ground and took hold of the handle of the machete that was sticking in the tree and pulled it free. He turned towards Janine and followed. Janine ran as fast as her feet would carry her, and suddenly came out into a clearing not far from the lake and burned dock that her dad, and brother had visited the day before. She could see it all in the distance, the dock, the burned down cabin, the construction site. But it was what stood between her and the familiar setting that sent a flood of defeat and despair through her entire being. The clearing was not so clear. The vast forest of trees was replaced by a vast forest of trioxites, and she had just ran smack dab into two of them. One of them grabbed hold of her arm. Her momentum swung her around to where she was facing the woods she had just fled from. All the undead she could see, including the one who now held her by her bicep, were mostly covered in snow and ice and moving slower than what she was used to seeing. The storm had done a number on them as well. Janine screamed as the trioxite that held her arm came in for a bite. It was obviously not an undead that rose from the grave. This one had a gnarly chunk missing from its neck, bitten while alive and turned in death. Its ice-cold flesh and putrid smell almost made Janine vomit her chips and granola bar. She pushed against the forehead of her new attacker, and the cold, clammy flesh began to pull away from its scalp. She felt all was lost. She had escaped Jason only to become supper for the undead. Then she saw Jason charging from the trees, machete raised high, his one eye only seeing Janine, not noticing the hundreds of walking undead littering his home. As Jason's machete came down, Janine dropped to the ground twisting, and in the process pulled the trioxite holding her into the path of Jason's blade. The machete came down on the collarbone of the walking corpse and cut diagonally through its torso all the way to its waist. Its blood and gore poured onto Janine's body, covering her clothes. If she had been looking up, it surely would have gotten into her eyes and mouth, and that would have been game over. Jason finally took notice of the new visitors of Camp Crystal Lake, as the horde had also taken full notice of him. Janine began to back away on the ground and froze as she turned her head behind her and saw more of the undead walking towards her and Jason. She stood, ready to fight off the undead, but the closest ones to her ignored her and walked right past her, making a beeline for Jason instead. Janine looked down at her trioxide gore-covered clothing, then around at all the undead, now passing right by her in large numbers. They seemed to not even know she existed. She stood and watched as dozens began to converge on Jason. But Jason was fast and began striking them down one by one with his machete. No matter how many came at him, he was able to take them down. They were moving much slower than normal due to the extreme cold. They weren't as sharp as some were known to be. A rage began to flood into Janine as she watched Jason swatting away the undead one by one like flies. She thought of Mark and her father, how this monster in the hockey mask had forever changed her life and taken away the only people she loved. This was her chance to get justice. The trioxites were hundreds, maybe more, and they were everywhere. But Jason was somehow able to continue slashing his way through them without tiring. Janine looked around in all directions, and her eyes fell upon the old construction site, and she smiled. Jason was surrounded by countless walking corpses, just like the ones that had come from the woods and the lake the day Mother had returned to life. He could see the girl, the last one of the group, who had invaded his home and taken Mother away from him. Jason's fury would not be stopped. He would have her. He would end her life, and nothing, not even every walking corpse before him, would stop him. He began swinging his machete into the undead that were coming at him. With each swing of his machete, his anger and wrath from losing his mother and her voice rose inside of him, and he was hit with a renewed sense of purpose and destruction. And Jason began mowing down trioxide after trioxide, slowly moving towards the girl that had gotten away. And then Jason realized he could no longer see her. As he swung his blade down at one corpse after the other, he kept looking all around him. The girl had to be nearby. The dead had ignored her for some reason, but Jason would not. And then Jason felt his blade thwack into a skull of a corpse, and when he pulled the machete away, the blade broke from the handle and remained lodged in the head of the creature as it fell to the ground in the pile of the dead at Jason's feet. Jason reached to his belt and removed two large hunting knives and began slashing his way forward, as if not missing a beat. And then he felt a stabbing pain explode in his back and turned his head to see the girl holding a large piece of rebar that was currently sticking into his back. Jason turned in fury, catching the girl off guard, sending her to the ground before she could let go of the bar. Jason finally would avenge Mother. He stood over Janine and rose his knife high above his head. But when he went to bring it down, several sets of hands had wrapped around both his arms and around his shoulders. He felt teeth tearing into his clothing and flesh. Janine slowly crawled backwards on the ground towards the cover of the forest as Jason spun back around and began throwing the undead off of him and slashing with everything he had. But in his moment of distraction with Janine, he had allowed even more than he could handle to get the upper hand, and they were on Jason, slowly overpowering him and bringing him to the snow-covered ground of Crystal Lake. Within moments, Jason was on his back, surrounded by dozens and dozens of the undead, ripping into his stomach, taking chunks of his arm and legs out with their teeth and hands, pulling his guts from his body, blood, bile, and gore oozing into the ground around him. The sun was shining directly into Jason's one remaining eye as he struggled to pull his arms up to keep fighting. Jason felt his hockey mask get pulled from his face, the straps ripping from the hard plastic. His deformed face was bare in the sunlight. As he struggled against the horde that was kneeling around him, holding him down and slowly devouring him, the sun suddenly became blocked out by a figure standing amidst the horde looking down at Jason. As his vision cleared, Jason saw her. Mother. Pamela Voorhees stood above her son. It wasn't her decayed, severed head, and it wasn't how she appeared when he saw her be decapitated by that counselor years ago. No, Jason was looking up at the mother who sung to him when he was small, the mother who held his hand as they walked around the Camp Crystal Lake grounds. She extended her hand to Jason and smiled proudly.
Jason, my special, special boy, Mother's here. Mother won't let you drown. Take my hand, son, Pamela said.
In that moment, Jason felt himself letting go of his anger, his frustration, his rage. He was letting go of the fire that burned inside him, that kept bringing him back time and time again. He had Mother. All he had to do was extend his hand, and Mother would protect him. Jason again tried to lift his arm free of the undead, not to fight back, but to reach for Mother. And this time, he was able to lift it without resistance. But when he saw his hand reaching up towards Mother's, he didn't see his large, grimy hand. He saw a hand that belonged to a small child. And all of a sudden, Mother was obscured by water. She was just above the surface of the water, reaching down. Jason reached with every ounce of willpower he had, and his mother's hand wrapped around his own small hand, and she pulled. Mother pulled Jason from the water and held him close.
Jason, Mother's got you. It's okay, my special boy. Let's go home, she said, and carried small Jason away to safety.
Jason was with Mother, and that was all he ever wanted. Nothing else mattered anymore. On the ground of Crystal Lake, the adult body of Jason Voorhees finally lay still. Its one remaining eye slowly closed forever. Within an hour, all that remained was a bloody, snow-covered indention where Jason once lay. Some tattered clothing and a battered hockey mask broken in half laid nearby. Epilogue. Head held high. Night had fallen as Janine drove down the deserted highway in the 1973 pea green Oldsmobile Delta 88 she had found and commandeered outside of Crystal Lake after leaving the campgrounds the same way she had entered them. Now, with the knowledge that there was a way to camouflage against the undead, she had stayed long enough to see Jason Voorhees meet his deserved end. He may have regenerated several times before, but she was now confident he was gone for good. After leaving the nightmare of Crystal Lake behind her, she had went through Senator Tom's bag and explored the contents of other folders he carried. She had a new purpose. She was going to make sure no one would have to suffer the fate her family had at the hands of monsters like Jason Voorhees. The undead still walk the earth, but she now knew there were beings out there far worse, far more terrifying, and far more deadly. Janine glanced over at the folder laying in the passenger seat, the one marked OP-SG-MM. As she passed a sign reading Welcome to Haddonfield, Illinois, population 19,078. A chuckle could be heard as a set of eyes watched from high above the Camp Crystal Lake grounds, as the horde of trioxides finished their meal and slowly began to rise and shuffle off in different directions, leaving nothing but red snow, tattered clothing, and a broken hockey mask behind. The eyes belonged to a long-dead child murderer, Freddy Krueger, whose severely burned, living, decapitated head sat atop a tall pike not far from where he and Jason had battled years before. He had been forced to exist for these past few years as nothing more than a decapitated trophy, forced to watch the grounds where his adversary walked. As the last of the undead moved on, he began laughing to himself.
Well, well, well. Looks like I won, bitch.
The end.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been the prologue of my short story, novella. I don't know how long it's going to be yet. It's still a work in progress. I'll release new chapters as I write them. Friday the 13th, quarantine. I've had a lot of fun thinking up this story and making the outline for it in my head and on paper, coming up with the characters that you're about to meet. There's going to be a group of survivors that are going to find their way out from the apocalypse outside Jason's walls and into Camp Crystal Lake. They're going to go there for security and safety, but I don't think that's what they're going to find. And I can't wait to take you all along for the journey as this story unfolds. I think you're going to really like a couple of the characters that you're going to meet in Chapter 1, And the way the events are going to play out in this story, I think it's going to keep you interested and on the edge of your seats waiting for the next chapter. It's going to be a crazy, wild ride, and I really hope you enjoy it. I knew where I wanted my story to be. I wanted it to be during a zombie apocalypse. Jason has become a prison in his own campground because the police, government, military, everything has given up on trying to capture him. And instead, they decided, to imprison him there to keep people out, keep him in, and keep him under observation. But then the world ended, I really wanted to get to the story, but I had to set up, how it all went down. And Trioxin just sounded like so much fun to throw into this story. But the regular Trioxin might have been a little too silly, brains and everything. So I went with the modified version of Trioxin, a general who had been deeply hurt and lost something very important to him, inadvertently caused the end of the world. He was only wanting to take out DC. I don't think he expected it to take out the entire world, but that's where we're going to be. When we get to chapter one, it's going to be about a year after where we left off with Jason going out to find animals to feed Mother. And it's going to be a lot of fun to see how this plays out. I hope you all enjoyed Jason having to fight against some of his past victims. I really had fun envisioning a zombie with its head twisted backwards, so it's kind of shambling backwards, reaching its arm behind itself. Because if it walked straight ahead, it wouldn't be able to see Jason. And I thought it was cool that Jason got to kill the two girls the same way that he had killed them in life. He killed their corpses the same way. I had fun making references to the other movies, like Freddy vs. Jason, Friday the 13th, The New Blood, talking about Tina's dad coming out of the water. And, I really wanted to play with the idea that Pamela's back. She might be a severed head that's reanimated and maybe even just using Jason to bring her food. But he's got Mother back, and, to Jason, I can see that how that would be very important to him and might even calm him a little bit, So it's going to be interesting to see how that dynamic plays out. Like I said, this is a work in progress. I'm still writing it. I don't exactly know exactly every bit of the story where it's going to go. I have an idea of where I want to get to. It's all still in play until we get there. So I'm excited to see where this story goes as well. What would happen if Jason lost his mother again? What kind of rage would that be? Okay, Slashaholics, this has been chapters 1 and 2 of my original Friday the 13th story, Friday the 13th Quarantine. A lot went down in tonight's chapters. I hope you enjoyed them. You got to meet our cast of characters. The senator, oh my god, what is he up to, right? Like, I know, I just can't tell you yet, but yes, he's definitely up to something. He definitely knew about Crystal Lake. You're going to find out how and what his real plan was, telling them. It sounds to me, if I was a listener of this book or reader of it, this is kind of what I'm going for. It was just a bait and switch. He needed protection. He gave them like this false hope of another base because he knew a safe place to go to, maybe from being a senator. So, but you'll get answers, I promise. You'll find out what OPCLJV stands for. I hope you enjoyed the little references tonight. Freddy's glove made another appearance. Maggot head, come on. We had to get Tommy Jarvis in there somewhere, or TJ as it were. I hope you enjoyed who our characters are going to be. The senator, the rich couple that are stuck up and lazy, the quiet twins, the dad and his two teenagers, and our fallen football star, Kevin. Kevin made a big mistake. He really wanted that 300th kill of a trioxide, and he just picked the wrong trioxide to kill for number 300. I hope you really enjoyed the way Jason took Kevin out, the stalking him, making Kevin think he was safe, using the axe. He wasn't trying to hit Kevin with it.
He was wanting to weaken the ice so Kevin couldn't run. And I love when Kevin found, when I was riding it, it's like, yes, yes, yes. And then Kevin realizes, you know, Jason wasn't trying to hit him with it, and he is fucked. And you have to remember that the apocalypse happened in, like, September of 2006. That's when it started. So when I decided that Kevin was going to be singing to himself, I had to find a hit song from the summer of 2006. That way, you know, it was still like a relevant song at the time that would have been stuck in his head even after the apocalypse. So you got to hear me singing Nasty Girl by the Notorious B.I.G. And also, you know, whenever he started thinking about the wall being like the one that held King Kong in, I kind of wrote him to do what we all do sometimes. We like go down a rabbit hole with our thoughts. So he's thinking about, it's nice to be inside walls as big as the ones that held King Kong. And then it was like, oh, and that movie with Jack Black was really good, the King Kong remake, which came out in 05, by the way. And then Jack Black, ah, damn it, I didn't get to see that Tenacious D movie. It was supposed to come out 2 months after the apocalypse started. Stuff like that. So I hope you like those references. And I got to tell you, there's a little thing I did with the cast of characters. Kevin's death, the way Kevin died, like what actually took his life away. If you think about his first name and the way he died, you might get that little hat tip that I have to Friday the 13th Part 1. But if you look at the cast of characters as a whole, their names and everything, see if you can figure out what the huge hat tip to Friday the 13th is. And I'll be looking forward to hearing from you all in the comment section. I hope you're enjoying the story so far. Jason has lost his mom again, has had her taken away, and this time there's no chance of a return. And this is a new Jason. This is a reborn Jason who is going to kill them all, and he's not going to take his time doing it. You know, they got Jason coming after him. They don't know it yet. A bad snowstorm coming to the point they probably couldn't leave and escape Crystal Lake back out into the zombie world if they wanted to. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been chapters 3 and 4 of my original story, Friday the 13th Quarantine. I really had a blast writing these two chapters and taking the story forward a little bit, from taking us back outside the walls to see that the horde is getting bigger and they are intent on getting inside these walls. And then taking us deeper into this story with the senator, what he knew about Crystal Lake. Because I'm finding this out at the same time you are, folks. I'm sitting down. I've got a basic outline of the story. But until I sit down to actually type it out, I'm not sure exactly what it's going to be. So it's a lot of fun for me, too, because this story is coming out and I'm presenting it to you. I hope you enjoyed the kills tonight. We lost both of the twins, Adrian and Sally Ann. You know, I did that poll about if a Friday the 13th story needs a sex scene or not, and I decided to kind of meet in the middle of not doing one and doing one, and that's what you got with Sally Ann and Kevin's little backstory and her little striptease at the window for, I guess, Jason, who I guess was throwing pebbles at the window to get her attention. But I thought the kills went great. I had a lot of fun writing them. And I should probably see a psychiatrist for making that statement. I hope that it wasn't lost in translation, you know, because sometimes the time of the story jumps around a little bit. Like when Chapter 3 started, we were with Harry and his kids as they were leaving to go check out the docks back in Chapter 2. So they saw Kevin as he was leaving to go cut wood before he got killed. Something similar happens when Harry shows up after seeing where Freddy vs. Jason took place at the dock and everything, and he's confronting Tom. The twins are in the back room. They hear him yelling. Adrian says she's going to go out there and listen. Sally Ann stays behind. Of course, Sally Ann dies. But then when we get back out in the main room, we're actually rewinding to before Sally Ann died. And Adrian's just now leaving the room. So while that argument is really intensifying, and Tom is explaining the first part of the Crystal Lake project and leaving out Jason, that is the period where Sally Ann is being killed in the room while we're experiencing that scene. I'm sure it wasn't lost in translation. I think I made it pretty clear in the writing. I really hope that you enjoyed these two chapters. I put a lot into them. The story's advancing pretty fast. We've probably only got 2-3 chapters left, plus an epilogue. I've got a hell of a couple more kills planned for you, and a hell of an ending, and I hope you're all going to stick around to check that out. I hope the story's keeping your attention and keeping you entertained. I hope I didn't go too sad with the twins' death. I hope you liked all the little references tonight, because, you know, we had Tommy Jarvis thrown in there. We went through a big timeline of things that happened in the Friday the 13th films. I kind of skated over the Jason Goes to Hell stuff, because it doesn't really attach to this universe's timeline, in my story's opinion anyways. But I did give it a mention with the FBI mission thing he kind of skips through. I'm sure that a lot of you Return of the Living Dead fans caught that Tar Man killed Harry's wife. Tar Man terrified me as a kid. Terrified me. To this day, just looking at him is kind of like, ugh. I hope you enjoyed, let's see here, Harry finally laying into Tom, the group finding out about Jason, Jason showing up and everybody running off in their different directions. The senator's passed out in the latrine pit. Good thing nobody used it yet. But, you know, he's laying out there passed out, and Jason's on his way out there. So when Chapter 5 rolls around, we're going to have to address that, aren't we? And, let me know what you all thought about the twins' deaths tonight. From the icicle to the eye, to Adrian being hung up on the antlers of a deer on the wall. And, I would really appreciate feedback and what you all think of the story so far. If you're enjoying it, not liking it, what you did like about it. And I love to talk to y'all about it. So I'm looking forward to hearing from you in the comments section. And I'll be back soon with more of the story. I'll be writing chapters 5 and 6 probably over the next couple days. And I'll get either chapter 7 done or the epilogue done. We'll see how fast it comes together. But I cannot wait to share the rest of the story with you and the ending I have planned. I think you're going to really like it. I hope you like Freddy's mention tonight, that his body was retrieved from the lake before Jason killed all the forensic people and the cops that came out to investigate the events of Freddy versus Jason. And that Jason kept the head and put it on a pike somewhere in Crystal Lake. Who knows, that head might pop up again somewhere in the story. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been the conclusion, chapters 5, 6, and the epilogue of my first attempt at a fan fiction Friday the 13th story of Friday the 13th quarantine. I was really excited the whole time I was writing this. I had a lot of fun doing it. The premise of this entire story came to me in a dream I had just a couple weeks ago. About a Friday the 13th type scenario during a zombie apocalypse at the end of the world. And when I first sat down to kind of outline my story, I had an idea of where I wanted the story to go, but as I wrote it, the story took on a life of its own. The characters took on a life of their own, and things went in directions I had never anticipated. I originally had thought to make it where Trioxin was in the air to the point that everybody had it in their system, and no matter how they died, kind of like on The Walking Dead, they would come back to life as a trioxide. But when I got to the part where that was going to come up with Kevin, what was going to happen is after Harry and them got back, Harry and his kids got back from the dock and told everybody they found the water tower and all that, everyone was going to ask where Kevin was, why he wasn't back yet. And Dorothy and Ron were going to say, well, there he is right now. And, you know, you as listeners or people that might read this in the future would surely know that Kevin was just killed, a couple scenes before. And he was going to show up as an undead, and they were going to have to fight him. And then Jason was going to show up, you know. But the story just kind of went its own direction as I was writing it, and that just seemed like it took away from the story I was trying to tell about Jason. Because this was a Jason story that just so happened to take place during an apocalypse, a zombie apocalypse. But it was never intended in my vision to be like a combination of the two, except for in the beginning and the very end. Jason's entire existence has been avenging his mother. I mean, that's what it all comes down to. And the way I set this story up was for Jason to have a renewed vengeance for the loss of his mother. You know, Kevin getting his 300th trioxide kill, and Jason losing his mother again. I could have wrote a couple chapters, you know, during that year between when she came back to life and before the survivors showed up. But I thought it was best to leave it to the listener or reader what he did for that year. You know, getting to hear his mom talk to him, hunting, bringing her animals and stuff for her to eat, even though she's just a head. You know, he wasn't thinking about killing people. He had no victims. You know, he had his mom back. He could let his vengeance go. And then, out of the blue, somebody shows up and takes her away from him again. Kills her for good this time. What kind of grief would a homicidal killer feel, you know? Because not only was she taken away physically, but he also wasn't hearing her voice in his head anymore. So he was truly alone, truly isolated. Didn't have his mother at all, even mentally. Would he feel stages of grief, you know? And the human characters I put into this story, I wanted them to feel a little more than just victim fodder for Jason. I wanted you to like them, hate them, get a kick out of them. You know, I really had fun writing for Ron Savinsky, just being this stuck-up entitled dude that just does not get it. Lazy as well. Tom, the annoyingly swarmy politician, and then Harry, the loving dad with his two teenagers, the twins who had their own connection, you know. So whenever I had to take my undead idea out of the story, you know, bringing back the victims, that's where I found I needed to have a way for Jason to kill one of the group without everybody else knowing. And I was able to organically weave into the story a kind of sex scene, which Friday the 13th requires. A lot of people tell me that. But I felt I could get that Friday the 13th feeling in there with the scene without actually having to do a sex scene completely. And it also gave me a way to organically kill off one of the characters in the cabin without the rest of the group knowing. And that was Sally Ann's kill. With a little backstory given that her and Kevin had hooked up, you know, had a little fuck buddy relationship. But yeah, I'm going to do an episode of Out of Print Slashers with Sean Campbell in the near future where I'll discuss things more. But I had a lot of fun writing this story. It was always supposed to be a story about Jason and his mother and him coming to terms with losing her and then, you know, finding her at the end. I always knew that Jason was not going to survive this story. That's why I kept stressing that this was an Elseworld, different universe. There is no Jason X. There's nothing that follows this. The remains of Jason that were eaten by all these different undead are not going to start regenerating. Jason let go of whatever was keeping him going, the fire that kept him going, because he found Mother. She reached into the water and pulled him out. Even though, you know, it was in a dying haze, or maybe he saw the spirit of his mom and she was pulling the spirit of him out. It's however you want to take that ending. But that was always where it was going to go, and I needed to build on that. His frustration, missing his mother, you know, while doing what he does best, killing these people. As far as the last two chapters go, I'll get to that in just a second. Let's see here. Setting up the backstory, the whole prison idea, that was part of the dream I had where Jason was like in this prison, where they made it around the Camp Crystal Lake grounds. It was fun piecing all that together. Making the apocalypse happen, skipping a year into the future, the group breaking in because the senator had some knowledge from, you know, oversight committee meetings in the Senate about this project. In the chapters tonight, chapters 5 and 6, and the epilogue, I hope that everybody appreciated some of what I wrote here. I had a lot of fun writing Tom's death, where he's sitting there trying to bargain and plead with Jason. And he makes the mistake of letting Jason know that he, Tom Wilcox, the senator, is the one responsible for bringing this whole group of people into Camp Crystal Lake. He thinks he's bragging, you know, boasting, showing Jason just how powerful and stuff he is and how he can do something for Jason. But all he ended up doing was letting Jason know that Tom Wilcox is completely to blame for Kevin killing Pamela. So I thought that it was only justified for Jason to bury him alive. You know, he had to bury his mother's head, and now Tom, who was responsible for that, got buried alive. But moving past that, I wanted to have a little levity in this story. You know, I had a little bit with Ron, you know, before people tell him to shut up, talking about how him and his wife made sure to hold the chairs down from flying away, and things like that. Some of the dialogue from Kevin to Jason, the twins calling Ron Thurston Howell from Gilligan's Island, or Harry calling him the Monopoly Man. But I decided that since I had been building up this thing about Ron having high blood pressure and then him and his wife having to run out in the snowstorm, he in his 60s, her in her 50s, to get away from Jason, I had this idea that he would stroke out right before Jason could swing the blade down. Kind of like in Child's Play 3, where the army guy has the heart attack and Chucky's like, "You gotta be fucking kidding me." You know, and so he strokes out and falls dead in front of Jason, and it just pisses Jason. At first it confuses Jason, like, well, this has never happened before. The dude just pissed himself, crapped himself, and died. But his rage got the best of him, and he cut the dude's head off anyways, which led to one of my favorite kills that I wrote in this book, which was supposed to be a lot shorter, by the way, like maybe 3 or 4 chapters. It kind of took on a life of its own, like I said, and became much longer, and I'm okay with that as long as you all enjoyed it. But yeah, Dorothy's death was the most fun to write. I had to look into how fast water would freeze coming out of a hose. It said if it was high pressure, it would take longer before the hose and stuff froze. So I made sure to make it a pump water hose that he had to, you know, hand pump it, hand crank it to pump it to get it to come out. So he got enough water on her before the hose froze, but I had this vision of Dorothy, you know, she's laying on her stomach, on her hands and knees, trying to get up to run after looking back and seeing her husband kill, you know, stroking out and then getting his head cut off. And as she stands, Jason, you know, swipes at her Achilles heels and then sprays her with ice cold water during a blizzard. You know, it's pretty much a blizzard at this point, howling winds, sub-zero temperatures, snow falling. So she's covered in ice cold water during ice cold temperatures and wind, and I just pictured it starting to freeze over her. I knew it wouldn't freeze her internally, but just the image of her trying to crawl away and having to go slower and slower because she has this layer of ice over her entire body, you know, the ice breaking around her fingers as she crawled. And then, you know, right as she's about to go, Jason comes up and just, you know, curb stomps her head into the ground. Again, showing that rage and frustration. The part I had the hardest time with was, you know, killing off Harry and Mark. Coming into the middle of the book, I actually really started enjoying the family dynamic they had, especially after I wrote the part about their mom being killed by essentially Tarman. Because after the Trioxin fell and Trioxides took over, some of the Trioxides could still talk and stuff, like the Return of the Living Dead movies. And the story didn't mention it, but once that happened, a lot of these Trioxin zombies went to military bases and stuff where Trioxin was stored in barrels, took it out, and began, you know, distributing it throughout the country and the world to create more. So places where graveyards didn't get hit with rain or fog or something on the day the Trioxin fell, these Trioxids would get barrels of Trioxin and take it to those areas and add to their army of the undead. So that's how Mark, Harry, Janine, and Allison, the wife, came across that warehouse with the barrel with Tarman in it. But, you know, I felt bad, you know. Janine lost her mom, killed by a Tarman and a couple other trioxides. And then, you know, Mark and Harry getting killed by Jason while they're, you know, they're on the run. Harry stepping into the bear trap. I had a much more brutal death planned out after he stepped in the bear trap, but I kind of put the story in the perspective of Janine at that point, and she was running, and she had just told her dad she loved him, she knew he was going to die, and I didn't think that she would look back to see it, so I just left that to the imagination of the reader or the listener, you know, what Jason actually did. You know, you hear, she mentions that her dad was yelling and then screaming and then silence. So that's up to you guys what Jason did. But the bear trap felt so painful as I was riding it. My ankle started hurting. And then we got to what I'd been building up to from the beginning of the story with Jason. And with the trioxides that were, you know, outside the grounds pushing to get in this whole time since chapter one. They finally got in. And while Harry and Mark are being killed and Janine is running from Jason, they got in completely. I knew in a Friday the 13th story I needed to include a pretty good final girl fight, or, you know, with Jason. And I hope I delivered on that in the woods, you know, whenever she baseball slid and almost got hit, where she dropped, he got his machete stuck in the tree. And then he started strangling her. She got a hold of Freddy's glove and put his eye out. I hope that that was a satisfying final girl fight. And I hope that you enjoyed Jason Voorhees versus zombies. You know, I could have went into detail about every single zombie that he struck down. But it's a horde of the undead. And Jason is just swinging his machete, taking them down. And I figured, all of you listeners and readers, you've listened to enough of these, read enough of these, you've got a great imagination, and I'm sure that you could picture Jason doing that like I could, and it was badass, pretty badass in my head, picturing Jason just swatting these undead down one at a time. You know, they'd been slowed down by the snow and the storm. But, you know, after a while, his machete is going to end up breaking, realistically, especially after, you know, mowing down dozens of these corpses, hitting all the bones and stuff. And I loved writing that after his machete broke, he just went right into it with the knives. And his rage and wrath to kill Janine, since she was the last one left that was responsible for his mom's head dying, that he completely turned his back to this horde to try to get her. And that's when the horde took him down. Because even Jason, you know, can't stop that many. And I really tried to make Jason unstoppable to a certain point, to where it took a lot of these things to take him down. And I gave myself a challenge. I said, can I make anybody feel bad for Jason Voorhees? After all the fucked up stuff he's done in this story, can I make people feel sorry for little Jason Voorhees, at least? The kid who drowned. Kind of the spirit of Jason that's deep down in there, you know, that just wants his mother. And I thought about Jason dying. What would that be like for Jason? What would he see? What would he think? And that's when it came to me that Pamela would be there to take him on, you know, to take him home. Whatever comes next. Whether it just all be in his head, or whether it was her spirit, or however you want to interpret it. I wrote that scene, almost choked myself up with it. I cannot wait to hear what you all thought about it. I know it's probably divisive. Some people are going to be like, why did you kill Jason? You know, why should I feel sorry for a killer like him? And it's not feeling sorry for the killer Jason. It's the little boy that's in there that, you know, just wants his mother, that keeps having her taken away from him. And I can't wait to see what you thought of that. Which brings us to the epilogue. I couldn't resist, you know, putting in this sequel setup. I don't know if there will ever be another story, you know, following Janine going after other slashers, but either way, you can kind of picture where it goes from there. There's also another reference in the epilogue when it talks about Janine and where she's going and how she's getting there. Did anybody pick up on that little horror movie reference? Let me know in the comments if you did. But yeah, I'm sure you all figured out by now OP-SG-MM is Operation Smith's Grove Michael Myers. And the population of Haddonfield, Illinois on the sign is 19,078 people. You know what that means, right? You caught that? I'm sure you did. And the coup de grace of the story, the head of Freddy Krueger got to watch it all. You know, it kind of sucks that Freddy technically did win the very, very long game, but I couldn't resist throwing in that little burn at the end from Freddy to Jason. And yeah, that's Friday the 13th Quarantine. That's my first story that I've ever attempted to write as a fan fiction, and really the first thing I've ever written this long that it could almost be like a short book. Like maybe the length, it's about the length of like the Tales of Terror Freddy Krueger books when it's all written out. And I was pretty insecure about doing this and putting it out to the world, but I really appreciate all the good feedback from everybody, and I'm glad you're enjoying it. And I hope that since you went along on this journey with me, that I delivered on the ending and I brought things full circle for you, and you walk away from this audiobook entertained. That's what I was going for. So please let me know in the comment section what you thought, if you enjoyed the book, if you enjoyed tonight's chapters and the epilogue. I love to hear from all of you. I look forward to it. It's a lot of fun chatting with you all about horror movies and slashers. Please consider donating to my Patreon. You can order a cameo from me or anybody on the channel. You can donate through PayPal or Cash App. All the information to help the channel is in the description below and in the pinned comment. We can't monetize the channel because of the type of content we have, so to keep the channel funded and going and growing, we depend on you. I want to say a happy early birthday to Rashad. He wrote a fanfiction Jason story that I'm going to narrate very soon here on the channel as well. And if you have any fanfiction that you've written and would like it narrated, please reach out to me on here. I'll tell you how to email me and everything, and we can chat, and I'll look into reading it here on the channel. Alright, until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying, be excellent to each other, and always remember, the sun never sets on those who ride into it. See you next time.